Magnificent spectacle here on the central arena at the moment, and you'll be seeing the banners very, very shortly from Collingwood and Richmond. They are huge and certainly worth seeing. But speaking of Collingwood, let's go to the Magpie dressing room now, and who else could we go to but Lou Richards?
There's the scene in the Collingwood dressing rooms, and everything seems nice and calm and serene. And of course, Collingwood haven't won a premiership for 22 years. And remember this, that the last time these two sides met was in 1929. That was 51 years ago. And of course, the system was different in those days. There was no, the side that finished on top of the league ladder had the right to challenge, hence the word grand final. Richmond beat them in the final by about 50-odd points. And in the grand final, because Collingwood had the right to challenge, they finished up defeating Richmond and winning the premiership by about 62 points. So I don't know whether history is going to repeat itself. Let's go back now to our central commentary position with Peter Landy.
Thank you, Lou. Well, as I mentioned, the banners are certainly huge. The entertainment is just about to get underway. So now it's my pleasure to introduce to you the official announcer for the 1980 VFL Grand Final, Ron Casey.
The Victorian Football League, we welcome you to the Moulinex 1980 VFL Grand Final between Richmond and Collingwood. The umpires for today's game, Bill Deller and Ian Robinson. Collingwood will play as selected. Bruce Monteith and Darryl Freem have been named as the additional two players to make the 20 for Richmond. The pre-match presentation is provided by the Combined Services Band, the Melbourne Chorale under the direction of Val Pyers, members of the Big M Little League, and Melbourne's own Mr. Peter Allen. Appreciation is extended to Thomas Nationwide Transport, Pan American World Airways, and of course the major sponsor of the Grand Final, Moulinex. Ladies and gentlemen, to set the stage for the game of the year, the 1980 Grand Final, the Combined Services Band under the direction of Sub-Lieutenant Ashley Green, Royal Australian Navy.
Collingwood's hopes of a premiership with this lineup. In a back pocket, they've selected 22-year-old Greg Strawn, playing in his 45th and most important game. At fullback is Emmett Dunn, who's been given the job of finding Collingwood's elusive forward, Craig Davis. In the other back pocket is Richmond's top defender, Michael Malthouse, who'll be all out to stop Collingwood's goal sneaks. On the halfback flank, Richmond have named young Terry Smith, a tough, fearless defender playing in only his 22nd game. Jim Jess, Richmond's brilliant centre halfback, could be just the player to hold Collingwood's Craig Stewart. He's a strong defender, and the Tigers will be looking for a big game from him today. Peter Welch, formerly from Hawthorn, will be another defender hoping to hold out the elusive Collingwood attack as he lines up in his 86th game on the halfback flank. Richmond will be looking for a big effort from their veteran speedster Brian Wood, who lines up on the wing for his 178th game. Geoff Raines will be looking for some of the form that he's shown all season when he lines up in the centre today. At 21, he's played 92 games for the Tigers. 20-year-old Stephen Mount has shown the great Tiger spirit by fighting his way back from injury to play on the wing today. Mervyn Keane, normally a solid defender, has been named on a half-forward flank, but wherever you play him, you can be sure of a determined effort. Richmond will be depending largely on the efforts of David Cloak at centre-half-forward today in their quest for the 1980 Premiership flag. Kevin Bartlett, Richmond's 33-year-old youngster, will be hungry for goals today in his 338th game. He knows what it takes to win premierships, and you can be sure he'll be giving his all. Richmond's veteran of 293 games, Francis Bourke, has been named in the forward pocket today. A gutsy, never-say-die player, he's been one of Richmond's most consistent players all year. The big question today is whether full forward Michael Roach can show the type of form that's written him into the record books as a century-kicking spearhead. Forward pocket player Robert Wiley is also dangerous near goals, and his form this year has delighted the Tigers. If ever Richmond needed a big game from Big Mark Lee, then today's the day. He's pitted against Collingwood's Brownlow medalist Peter Moore in what should be a great battle of the giants. Ruck rover Barry Rowlings has fought his way back from injury to appear in today's grand final, and he's another player the Magpies will need to keep an eye on. Richmond have left their options open on the interchange bench by naming skipper Bruce Monteith, Ian Scrimshaw, Darrell Freem, Dennis Collins and Michael Nugent. Can Collingwood make it premiership number 14 after 22 heartbreaking years? Back pocket player Andrew Ireland will certainly be doing his best to help the Magpies achieve their impossible dream. So too will Peter McCormack, who will have the unenviable job of holding Michael Roach. Tough back pocket player Stan Magro gives little away, and today should be no exception. Ray Byrne played a magnificent halfback flankers game against Geelong last week, and he'll be hoping to repeat that performance today. Collingwood high flyer Bill Pickett always seems able to find that little bit extra in grand finals, and Magpie supporters are hoping he can do just that against Richmond's David Cloak. Players don't usually need any extra incentive to play well in grand finals, but halfback flanker Kevin Morris would dearly love to help beat his old club, Richmond. Winger Lee Carlson may not have had the best of days against Geelong's Michael Turner last week, but he epitomised the Magpie spirit of never giving in. Collingwood expect big things from 19-year-old Peter Dacos, and he's proved capable of producing them on many occasions. The Magpies will be hoping that today is his day. Speedster Ricky Barham is back on the wing after injury and will add extra pace to the centre line. His impressive runs deep into the forward line have proved a headache for defenders all season, and the wide open spaces of the MCG will give him plenty of room to stretch his legs. Remy Kink has found form on the half-forward flank at the business end of the season and is capable of changing the course of a game single-handed. Centre half-forward Craig Stewart has been proving quite a headache for opponents lately. His strong marking and accurate kicks for goal are an asset to the Magpie attack. Ian Lowe on the half-forward flank is the type of player you can't let out of your sight. If you do, it could result in a valuable goal. Forward pocket player David Young is smart and elusive near goal, and he too can cause some big headaches for defenders. 26-year-old Craig Davis is deadly accurate when shooting for goal and is a good mark and clever on the ground. Magpie fans will be hoping he makes the most of his opportunities today. Skipper Ray Shaw is a tenacious player who never cares about the size of the opposition. When resting in the forward pocket, he can be dangerous near goal, and when roving, clears the way for many of the Magpies' forward thrusts. 1979 Brownlow medalist Peter Moore is one of Collingwood's most valuable players. As he's proved time and time again, when he takes over a game, he's very hard to stop. Russell Olsen, Collingwood's determined ruck rover, is a consistent ball handler and great team man. He'd be certainly hoping he can play well enough to help the Magpies win today. Ron Wimmer, Collingwood's cheeky little rover, is very fast and loves to run around the wings and flanks. He hopes he can be running with the Premiership Cup held high later this afternoon. Collingwood have gone for pace on their interchange bench. Michael Woolnow and 20-year-old Tony Shaw are both capable of giving their best when called upon.
Ladies and gentlemen, the combined services band, Army, Navy and Air Force. Born in Tenterfield, New South Wales, now from Broadway, New York, West End in London, one of the most prolific singer-composers in the world today, a man who is proud to call Australia his home. Ladies and gentlemen, would you welcome to Grand Final Day, Mr. Peter Allen.
that never closed down. Like New York, Rio, and old London town. But no matter how far or how wide I roam, I still call Australia home. And I'm always traveling, 'cause I love being free. And so I keep on leaving the sun and the sea. But my heart lies here waiting over the phone, 'cause I still call the MCG home. All the sons and daughters spinning round the world, away from their family and friends. But as the world gets older and colder, it's good to know where you're journeying. Someday we'll all be together once more, when all of the ships come back to the shore. Then I realize the one thing I've always known, I still call Australia home.
Shot at this magnificent packed MCG today, estimated attendance over 115,000. And as I said, Lou and Bob, what a magnificent spectacle.
Well, it's a magnificent shot from the Channel 7 helicopter, and that just shows you the feeling. And I think that people sitting at home right throughout Australia are in for a treat today, and I hope that you people that are viewing it through the 7 network are getting the same feeling as that we are, because I mentioned before about Bob Skilton. It's a big welcome to you, Bob, too, for this 1980 Grand Final for the VFL.
Thanks very much, Lou, and I know you were speaking about the atmosphere before, but I personally, it doesn't matter what Grand Final it is, I think the older I get, the more keyed up I get, and the more exciting each Grand Final becomes.
I agree with you.
Whether or not it's the fact that they're putting more and more emphasis on the presentation and everything, Peter, I really don't know, but there isn't anything in Australia like that Grand Final.
Well, I must agree with you. The presentation here today has been superb. The atmosphere all week was likewise. Let's see if we can capture some of that from the 7 National News helicopter. And here is John Deeks.
Thank you very much indeed, Peter Landy. And last week on World of Sport, live from the city square, the president of the VFL, Dr. Alan Ayler, remarked that, in his opinion, no sporting spectacular exists to rival the VFL Grand Final. And, of course, from our vantage point high above the MCG, you can feel the electricity and anticipation for what will be a magnificent climax to season 1980. We just flew over the Yarra a short time ago, and we could see some people down there in the barbecue area with portable TVs having a really good time. So everyone's going to really enjoy Seven Sports' exclusive coverage of the 1980 Grand Final Day. But right now it's back to Peter Landy.
Thank you very much indeed, John. And the umpires coming out onto the ground now. Predictably, Lou, Deller and Robinson. Maybe Kevin Smith a little bit unlucky. And also we could apply the same to Glenn James.
That's right, Peter. But I would say that these two fellows, Bill Deller and Ian Robinson, have been the most consistent. They are the two top umpires in the VFL. And I'm quite sure that they'll do the job justice today. And I think Bob winning three Brownlow medals would certainly back me up on that one.
I think both umpires are justifiably proud of being out there and have earned their the task of being out there. And talking about being out there and just having watched the Geelong win the Commodore Cup, Lou, made me think of Bill Ryan, who this year captain and coach Southport to a premiership up there. And I know that Bert Robinson and all of 4GG who've been watching right throughout this year have a big day with the Gold Coast Australian Rules Clubs at the Pacific Hotel, watching on that big giant screen.
Here come Richmond now, led by Captain Bruce Monteith, followed by David Clark and Robert Wiley. The Tigers.
Well, the players each have a football and they'll be kicked into the crowd, and this gives the atmosphere more purpose, Peter.
I see Freem running out too, Lou. He was one of five players named on the interchange bench. He's the red-headed rover. Collingwood will be out in 2 minutes if the VFL stick to their schedule, and they have done so far meticulously today. And we can see the black and white balloons, thousands of them, making their way up towards the sky.
Well, there's a sight and a half, isn't it? That's magnificent, and I don't think you'd see anything better in the world at a sporting venue. And we at Channel 7 are very proud to have this telecast going right through. There's the coach of the Richmond football team with all the worries in the world, and rightly so, because this is the day they all wait for. Every coach's ambition to get into this grand final and take off the coveted grand final for 1980 or whatever year it may be.
Bob, we saw David Cloak come out and Barry Rowlings. Now, there was a cloud over these players, not because of their fitness, but because they are not match conditioned at the moment, having not played a match for about a month.
Well, I think at this stage of the season, though, Peter, that's not quite as bad as early in the season, because the rest, in many cases, may probably stand them in good stead, because they certainly wouldn't have lost a great deal of condition over that period. And, you know, just as they say in old racehorse parlance, first up after a spell is often pretty good anyway. So I think that I'm sure that those players will give a good account of themselves. Just looking out there, there are probably a few players who only a few weeks ago did not expect to be there. Take, for instance, Peter Welsh, the former Hawthorn player. I think 3 weeks ago he was an interchange player for the Commodore Cup side.
He was, that's right.
Well, another thing too, Bob, he did so well against the Geelong champion that you saw last week, Michael Turner, and Richmond played Geelong, that he's won his place back in the side. It'll be interesting to see where he plays today, whether he'll play on Ricky Barham, the Collingwood speedster. One player that we're going to watch today is Kevin Bartlett. He's the name, as the Magpies coming down the race now.
I notice you said wee-loo.
Well, I can't help saying that, Pete, because
yeah,
I just
always
felt tickled big about it. Well, I think you'd be the same, Bob. They've waited 22 years for this, and if they're ever going to win a premiership, this should be the one. I know we've said that many times before. But I thought Collingwood may have been coming down with the chip as the banner going up, but the Magpies keeping the Richmond side out there.
Isn't that a magnificent banner too, Lou? Sorry to interrupt, but that banner, the work that goes into that is unbelievable.
Well, the kids are marvellous. They do a great job, the boys and girls of the cheer squads, and they are a big part of the celebrations and the, well, the preamble before the grand final, Peter.
Well, Collingwood a little bit late now. I think they were due out at 2:22. And I would imagine any tick of the clock, we would be seeing the Magpies. They'd be itching to get out there. There's Ron Weirmouth. I can see Ian Lowe in the background. Shaw. There's Tony Shaw, the brother of the skipper, Ray. He was named on the interchange bench, but of course I'm sure both coaches would have a few tricks up their sleeve as to where and who will actually line up in the 20.
Tommy Hafey, the coach, at the back there with the T-shirt on. That's the traditional dress for Hafey. The players, you can see them saying, come on, we've got to go out there and win this. And it's a tremendous feeling you have in the dressing room when you're playing a grand final, to come down there, down that race and break that sound barrier, because you just feel as all the butterflies in the world are coming out of your tummy, yeah, Peter?
Lou, Kevin Bartlett, you mentioned before, he's kicked 7 goals and 8 goals in the two finals that Richmond have played to date. Which of the Collingwood defenders, Ireland, Byrne, who, Morris, who will be given the job in your opinion?
Well, I don't know. I'm pretty sure they won't move Magro on him because he's such an important player down there in the back pocket, picking up or backing up McCormack. I'm inclined to think that Hafey may leave Kevin Morris do the job and see how well he goes against him.
I think you'll find Ireland will be the man.
Well, it could
I'll
be.
I'll go for Byrne there. Well, we've got
three defenders.
That's right.
There's Magro there, Stan the man, one of the tough players of Collingwood, but one of the inspirational players. And look at him urging his players. Look at Hafey going there to town. Brother Ron, all in there having a go. All putting their two pennants worth in, Bob, and really trying to urge their players on, because if you can get away early in the piece, you get yourself settled down, and away you go.
Here they come now, going out the door, and you'll see them coming onto the hallowed MCG turf in a few moments' time. The crowd hears them, some of them see them, and very soon Collingwood will be breaking that very, very spectacular banner. Here they come now, led by Captain Ray Shaw, followed by Kevin Morris.
Tony Gillett, the black and white blue one's going up in the air now, and this, you know, this is a marvellous spectacle, and wherever you may be throughout Australia, I think you must be getting the feeling now, because if you love football, if you love sport, Bob, that's enough to send you up the wall, really, isn't it, with excitement?
Very much so, Lou, and those people that have been watching you and Peter right throughout this year around Australia must certainly see the culmination of those many weeks coming to fruition out there right now. And this is what the whole season is about. We play our 22 games and our early finals, all to bring about the grand final and ultimately a premiership team.
Marvellous thing about this, Pete, all these people come here today to see the start of the game, and the Collingwood supporters and the Richmond supporters will be glad when it's over. Strange enough, the quicker it can get over, the better for them, they'd possibly say. There's the crowd now, and they're really on their toes at the moment for the first bounce.
Well, the hotel people tell us that around Melbourne and suburbs, you can't get a bed anywhere. Most restaurants in Melbourne are totally booked tonight. Very big week in Melbourne. Be a big week out in Johnston Street too, I would imagine, if Collingwood win, and I dare say the same would apply at the new Richmond Social Club if the Tigers were to take off the flag, which would be their first since 1974. Collingwood's first, as I said, since 1958.
Ray Shaw there, the umpire talking to Ray Shaw, and there's Bill Della, the other umpire. Ian Robinson and Bill Della will take over the show today. And of course, there's the goal umpires and the boundary umpires.
I would doubt very much whether you'd find that both goal umpires, that's reversed there, the boundary umpires are Lee Patterson and Jeff Wilcox, but both goal umpires named Barker. Now, I don't know if they're related at all, but very, very unusual.
No relation, Bob. We checked on that before lunchtime, and they are no relation.
Both teams and the umpires now lining up in front of the MCC members' stand for the playing of the national anthem, which will be sung by Peter Allen.
You ever get the urge to go out there and play if you're at our age? You feel as though you could run down there, don't you, when they run down the race?
You mean at your age or Bob's age?
Well, both their ages. It's a wonderful feeling, and you get a lump in your throat. I think Bob will go along with that.
I can feel the adrenaline flowing now, Lou, and I think that if you didn't have it going, as Renee Kink is there, and I think the tension is shown there, you know, just with the actions of Renee Kink, the movement. I'm sure he doesn't actually need a drink at this stage, but he's probably that dry in the mouth from nerves.
Advance Australia Fair, followed in the presence of His Excellency the Governor-General, Sir Zalman Cowan, by God Save the Queen.
sustained affair. God save the Queen. Probably will be a little bit late in starting because we have to have all the equipment moved off the ground.
Bobby, I don't suppose one player out there out of the 40 players, 20 from each side, would have heard one note played out there when they're playing the Australia Fair song and or the Australian National Anthem and the National Anthem.
No, it's amazing how you can be in a position with all of the noise that one could think of possible and yet not hear a word because of the concentration, thoughts of the coaches. Instructions going through their minds, the job that's at hand, each player given a task, whether he be on the forward line, Michael Roach and David Pope may be the focal point of the Richmond attack, whilst at the other end of the ground, the quiet defence and everything else. We see there the people are really under pressure, Lou.
Well, the two coaches on the left of the screen is the Collingwood coaches box, and that's Tommy Hafey on the edge there, Ron Richards, Thurl Merritt, and Neil Mann and Wayne Richardson. We go across to the Richmond room, right across there. That's Tony Jewell, Alan Cook. I've got to pick up the other fellas there. I'm not quite... There's Paddy Ganane.
John Robinson.
John Robinson.
I think Alan Cook's chairman of selectors, but John Robinson is certainly a selector.
Yeah, well, there they are. And, of course, this grand final will be no different to any other grand final because you'll find at the beginning, particularly for the first 10 minutes, there'll be a lot of mistakes because of the tension and the over-anxiousness of each player out in that ground. Richmond won the toss and they're kicking to the right of the screen. Well, I think once the players settle down, Pete, that they seem to get back to their normal style of game.
As I mentioned, Lou, we will be a little bit late in starting with this band equipment still being moved off the ground. They did utilise a tractor to get it out there and that's going to take it off. And there are three or four timpanis which the band used, still will be taken off as well, plus a couple of sponsors' signs and a few extraneous cables for cameras and what have you, plus a dais, which you can see, a rostrum. So probably the game will be about 5 minutes late in start.
Peter, I think we should mention this too, and Bobby also. The ground itself looks in magnificent condition and full marks to the curator of the Melbourne Cricket Ground because it's ideal condition for football today.
And with the actual weather the way it is, Lou, with hardly a breath of wind, then it's certainly great for football.
And we would like to welcome to our viewers across the Tasman in New Zealand. We hope that you're receiving the telecast loud and clear. We know a lot of expatriate Australians over there, and we might be able to educate a few New Zealanders as to the finer points of Australian football as distinct from rugby union. The All Blacks, of course, have made many tours of Australia and they're always most welcome here. But as you can see, the game of Australian football draws the crowds in Melbourne.
Pete, I think the only reason that we wouldn't break the record for attendance today is that since the 120-odd thousand...
121,698.
Since then, the health department have shut the doors on a few of the standing room and so on, and that would be the only reason that we wouldn't break records today.
And that record was set 10 years ago when Carlton played Collingwood in a memorable grand final, Collingwood leading by 44 points at half-time, Carlton coming back through the agency of a little blonde guy called Ted Hopkins, and they really came back at Collingwood and ultimately took the flag.
And it's 51 years since these two sides have met in the grand final, and on that occasion Collingwood won the grand final because they had the right to challenge. It was a different system altogether, we mentioned before.
We did mention before, Lou, about a couple maybe of, I won't call them suspect players, but players who have been out with injury. The same thing must apply to Ricky Barron.
Yes, it must.
Bob, see if you can pick up who is minding Bartlett as the players take up their respective positions. Richmond will be kicking towards the right of screen. That's the main scoreboard in. Collingwood will be kicking towards the left of screen. And we see Freem on the ground too, the red-headed Richmond.
I think they're all out there so far, Peter.
Yes.
I think Tony Jewell might be playing a little bit smart, leaving the 20 players out there to the final moment. Then whip his 19th and 20th men off the interchange players off the ground. There's Bartlett on camera, and it'll be interesting to see who picks up Bartlett, kicking 14 goals in his last two final matches.
Well, they're not too anxious to take up their positions.
I think they're all trying to outsmart each other, Pete.
You'd be right. They're milling around the centre. Nobody really keen to take up positions. Still, we've got 40 players out there. We haven't got two moving off the ground. I think three might be one of them. for Richmond, the redhead. He's right on the VFL logo now. There he is. He's number 44. I think we'll see him move off very quickly. He's going to the interchange lanes. And let's see who else is coming off. It's Monteith, the Richmond captain. He's starting on the interchange bench.
So the 18 has selected virtually, Peter. And the same applies to Collingwood.
Well, Nugent and Scrimshaw, therefore, would not line up with them. They're the two players that would have been omitted. And we see Woolnough and Tony Shaw. Well, that's as selected for Collingwood. Michael Woolnough, the former Geelong player. Pretty useful player to have on the interchange bench, too.
I think Byrne will be the player to mind. We're just waiting now. Bartlett's still on his own down there. No one picking him up. But maybe Kevin Morris coming over to pick him up now. Yes, he is.
Well, who was right? Who picked Kevin Morris?
I think I'm...
The crowd's starting to warm up to this big sight as umpire Della will bounce the ball to start the game. And we're waiting for players to settle down. And just having a look at any positional changes at the moment. David Cloak has Billy Pickin on him. He towers over Billy Pickin. First bounce almost underway now. Jimmy Jess is down at centre-half forward. Up goes Mark Lee. Got a slight tap. It went toward Weirmouth. He got his head underneath the arm there of the big Richmond player. But the Richmond player had him dropping the ball. And Raines will take this free kick. So Raines gets the first kick of the match and he kicks it long. Right down toward Roach. Roach is up and off. So too is Peter Moore. Peter Moore was up in front of him. He took the mark and passed out quickly to Andy Ireland. Ireland down toward the centre of the ground. Up will go Craig Stewart. He's in front. He took the mark in front of Burke. Burke's playing centre half back and out it goes wide. It's coming over now towards the Collingwood player who was Dacos. And Dacos has got it up forward and taking the mark down there is Young. David Young of Collingwood, right up toward the teeth of goals, a point. It's through for one behind, and first blood goes to Collingwood. After only about 32 seconds of play, and Young will be credited with that one. The fullback to kick in. Trying to pick up, this might be Mickey Malthouse kicking in. He's always has his left wrist bandage, and Mickey Malthouse for Richmond kicks the ball into the member stand side of the ground. Up will go Rene Kink, and he's taken the mark. Kink was in the front position. Collingwood play in front. That's the message they play to. That's their doctrine, and that's the way they play. Always in front. And Craig Stewart's already taken one mark by being in front. And so too now has Rene Kink. Here's his kick at goal. It's going to be offline. In fact, it'll drift out of bounds on the full. And the first out of bounds on the full has been decided, and Malthouse will take the kick yet again. No, he's not. He's handing it back now. This could be Strawn to take this kick. A few positional changes. We'll get those picked up in a moment or two as Strawn kicks the ball back on the member stand side, looking up there for Mark Lee. Mark Lee's pushed out more, and no, it's gone the other way. In fact, neither Mark Lee nor Moore get the kick. It's Emmett Dunn who will take it for Richmond and kicks right into the centre of the ground, looking for Wood. Wood's up high, takes a good mark over Carlson, immediately with a right foot kick, right down towards centre forward. Up will go Roach, trying to mark it one hand, can't do it, and he gets the free kick. McCormick's got him by the hand. Umpire Della says, you got him by the hand. Well, it certainly was able to say in the call that he was trying to mark it one-handed. And it looked as though he was being grabbed, but sometimes full forwards lean across and push out. And Neil Kerley thinks he just stuck his hand there. And Roach gets the first chance to goal for Richmond. He's about 45 metres out on a 55-degree angle. It's on its way through for a point. Won the flag only. And after 2 minutes of play, they're 1 point each on 3LW Greater Melbourne Building Society. Tommy Lahiff, the positional changes.
Jess to centre-half forward, Bourke to a back pocket, Mount to centre-half back, Wiley is roving, Waitman a forward pocket, Cloak to a forward pocket, and Morris has picked up Bartlett.
Right, here's Bill.
And McCormick kicks the ball back into play, travelling around the members' flank, up towards the half-back line, taken by Craig Davis. Launches, he kicked the ball, it goes to centre wing. Barham kicks the ball about a metre off the ground, goes up towards Stewart, making position still on the members' side, reaching the half-forward flank, picked up by Mount. Mount, a quick hand pass out the general direction of the boundary line, and Richmond go forward, kicking to centre wing, and Welsh takes the mark. Welch at centre wing position, members side, and Richmond attacking down to the railway or scoreboard end. The boot is up towards the half forward line. Roach came out there, couldn't get under control, but he does when he hits the deck, kicks it quickly, and the smother is by Magro to see the ball smothered over the line. Out of bounds on the half forward flank for Richmond on the members side, kicking towards the scoreboard end. A point, Collingwood a point, Richmond a point on the 3RW Greater Melbourne scoreboard. The ball thrown back into play. Wiley's height enables him to punch away. Magro gets it under control and is tripped in doing so, and Magro will take the free kick on the half-back flank on the members side of the ground. He kicks it through the centre, up towards the centre half forwards position, knocked away by Stewart, but Wood will relieve the pressure. Hand passes to Bourke, and Bourke goes up to half-back flank on the outer side of the ground, kicking long over towards Rowlings. Rowlings up on the half forward flank, doesn't bother to use speed, kicks the ball immediately up towards the half forward line, thumped away by Ireland, down to Olsen, and Collingwood relieve the pressure, going to the outer side of the ground and across to Carlson, and Carlson will get the free kick on the outer side of the ground and on Collingwood's half back line.
And Wood's been taken back on the mark for 15 metres. He doesn't want to let Carlson go. Carlson immediately plays on now and kicks right up toward Craig Stewart's in there between two Tigers. Up goes Emmett Dunn, comes out the back. Here's a chance for Lowe to put it through the eye of a needle, and he doesn't. So Bobby Rose was wrong there, as Lowe had the open goal in front of him. Shot, no angle to worry about, and put it through for 1 point only. 4 minutes gone on the 3RW Greater Melbourne Building Society scoreboard, and Connie would have got two behinds, and Richmond one as we wait for the ball, and Mickey Malthouse is going to kick that ball back into play yet again. Mount's giving a lead out on the member stand side, and it's coming out that way, and up will go Emmett Dunn and Craig Stewart. No, they can't take the mark. It comes to Welsh. Welsh of Richmond is able to break clear from the tackle, and then with a right foot kick down to Jess. Jess has got it. Macro's 15 metres on Magro, who grabbed Jess by the head, and Magro's let his man grow Blake free. It goes to Waitman. Waitman's going to line up in the forward pocket. He's put it through. It's a goal. Error on Magro. Magro made a bad mistake then. Rather stupid. He gave away a deliberate 15 metres on Jess after Jess took the mark. He grabbed him round the neck. He tried to wrestle him to the ground. And that meant, and out comes Hafey, no doubt to speak to Magro. And Waitman got away, made an easy pass for Jess, and Waitman went goalwards and put it straight through the centre. So Richmond have hit the front by this error of Stan Magro's. Richmond are one goal, 1-7 points, and Collingwood are two behinds as the ball's bounced back in the centre.
At 6 minutes into the first quarter, and it's a good bounce and high there as leader get it down, but it went to Ray Shaw, and he's smothered by players, and notably Wylie will take the free kick. Shaw's in the centre of the ground. He chooses to go to the outer side. The ball swinging out towards the half-forward flank on that outer side of the ground. Knocked to the ground away from Young into a pack of players. Coming out, and it'll be taken away there by Malthouse. Malthouse over to centre wing position on the outer side of the ground to find Rowlings. He's gone back to the half-back line, kicking up towards centre wing now, and the mark is taken by Wylie, coming around the outer side, looking for Bartlett, but it was just a little bit too long, and it went over the line out of bounds with Bartlett in hot pursuit. On the 3RW Greater Melbourne scoreboard, it's Richmond 1-1 and Collingwood 2 behinds.
Incidentally, Kevin Morris has picked up Kevin Bartlett. So those two old teammates playing against each other.
On the half-forward flank for Richmond, outer side, travelling up towards the railway or scoreboard end, the ball thrown back into play, and Lee and Moore, 50-50 there. It found its way to Carlson, in turn to Ray Shaw with handball, and Ray Shaw from the half-back flank transfers it up towards centre wing. Stewart coming from the side is not good enough, and Mount knocked it to the ground, picked up by Wearmouth. He hand-passed frantically out anywhere, and it's pounced upon by Raines, and Raines whips it into the centre of the ground. Coming downfield now, a chance for Welsh. He went straight into Magro, down to the ground it goes to go to Kink. A hand pass out to Barham on the member side of the ground, and Ricky Barham twists and turns, handballs long back into the centre there. Dacos doesn't know where to go, but he got it to Magro at centre half forward, and he runs through that position and kicks long up towards the goal front. The Richmond defence knock it away, but there's a free kick to Collingwood. There's a free kick up here to Craig Davis in front of goals at the punt road end. The angle is little to speak of, and the distance only about 15 metres out. Eight and a half minutes into the first quarter, Craig Davis lines them up and kicks Collingwood's first goal in the grand final of 1980. And the Magpies hit the front on 1-2-8. They lead Richmond 1-1-7.
All right, at that time, let's take a comment firstly from Rex Hunt,
It's been a fierce opening, but Collingwood are playing particularly well. They're gaining great drive from Dacos in the centre, and apart from one mistake by Magro, are holding up all right in defence.
What do you think of things, Neil Kerley, at this stage?
It's a pretty tight opening. It's amazing. The two full forwards have both had shots from goals for three kicks, and I didn't think were there, but it's a very fierce opening, and both sides have settled down well.
OK, Ian Robinson about to move in to bounce the ball. He comes in, and Peter Moore coming with a run. It doesn't quite favour him as Lee had the run at the ball. Got it right down long. It's coming toward Bartlett. He's been minded very closely by Kevin Morris. I thought he got pushed aside. My word, that was I think that was a pretty technical one. Morris just seemed to push Kevin Bartlett aside. But Bartlett's got the free kick. And Kevin Bartlett will kick from this free kick in by umpire Bill Deller. From about 45 metres out, and he's virtually directly in front of goal. Kevin Bartlett, the veteran of the scene, kicks it long, but it's through for 1 point only. Just made it, one behind from that particular free, and Kevin Bartlett had a golden opportunity to put his first goal on the board, and we will see it being kicked in now by McCormick. McCormick of Collingwood, down with Rene Kinks in front. Has it knocked away from him by Smith. Good tackle there. But Ray Shaw gets it given against him. And in the back is the decision to Kevin Bartlett again. So this time he's too far out from goal. Peter Moore will take his easy mark. Up he goes. He's got it. And Cloak. Peter Moore dropped the ball. Tried to get out with a 15-metre. Yes, Tom?
I think Barham hurt his leg the first time he went for it. Have a look at his right leg.
Yes, Ricky Barham has been shaking that right leg quite a bit when he did slip over early. And perhaps he is favouring it. It's come off hands of Pack now. It's gone to Rene King. He slips just as he's about to kick the ball. Hand passes it nicely to Picken. Picken in turn kicks it long. But Francis Burke's in front there. And Francis Burke takes the mark in front of David Young.
And he's near enough to centre-half back defending at the punt road end. Comes in now to kick through centre-half forward favouring the outside of the ground. Nobody seemed to want it. Cloak went in belatedly, but it bounced off his chest to Picken, and Picken's kicked across the ground, and Welch has come up from centre-wing to half-forward flank to take the mark. He was looking for a free kick as he edged himself into Barham rather than Barham into Welch, but Welch has got the mark on the half-forward flank on the member side, and they're kicking down towards the scoreboard end. The kick is off the side of the boot slightly, but it'll make some distance upfield. Roach came from behind McCormick. He set himself a little bit of a nudge there, but he came from behind, and with those long arms of his outstretched, took the mark plumb in front of goal at the scoreboard end, and a chance for Richmond to post their second goal. It's a matter of 15 metres out, if that. It'll be 15 to 18 from the time he comes in to kick. And he's lining them up now to put it on its way, and there's no doubt about that one. It's a goal to Roach, a goal to Richmond, and they're looking good in the opening moments to move on to 2-2-14. They lead Collingwood 1-2-8 on the 3RW Greater Melbourne scoreboard.
OK, let's go back to the back stalls up there and talk to Polly Perkins. Paul, how do you think your side's opened?
Well, they've settled down very well, as Neil Kerley said, and I think the pressure's on Collingwood now to turn and try and counter their attack.
OK, Greg Brown looking at it from a Collingwood viewpoint.
Well, Collingwood started off, I thought, pretty well, settled down quicker than Richmond, but it's the marking power on the forward line. Roach is looking a big danger for Collingwood.
OK, today we've got Gary Bryce and Polly Perkins looking from the Richmond's viewpoint. We've got Greg Brown and Frank Considine from Collingwood as we see the ball come back into the centre. Perfect bounce there by umpire Ian Robinson. Up goes Lee and out stretches and out defeats. There's a free kick coming up to Picken. Defeats big Mark Lee. Mark Lee defeated Peter Moore there because it was a perfect bounce. The ball came down, Picken went to pick it up and got a tackle too high, and he gets the free kick. He's in that centre square. It's a shocking kick by Picken. Gone straight off the side of the boot, out toward the centre wing position on the outer side of the ground. Punched away down there by Raines. It's going to favour Collingwood after it. Ooh, it's pretty close to the boundary line. And I think tumbling out with the ball over there was Kevin Morris. Is that Morris over there?
Byrne, I think.
Yeah, Ray Byrne moving right up there. Well, up they go again. This time I thought Craig Stewart tapped it down, but the ball was picked up by Richmond. Kicked down toward Raines. Raines tapped it across. They've lost the run of it. Hand pass by Collingwood to Lee Carlson. Carlson's kicked it long with a left boot. Trying to take the mark will be low. He can't. And it's gone just over the boundary line to be thrown in. But it's right at the punt road end. It's beside the virtually beside the behind post, and a chance for Collingwood to convert. Going in for the ruck will be Stewart and Dunn. Up went, it might have been Craig Davis, the finish, that tapped that out. but he tapped it out of bounds. And there's a tackle then on Wearmouth given by umpire Della. And Della has paid the free kick to Wearmouth. Incidentally, Bill Della's not afraid to pay these free kicks in front of goal or near the goal area. This one, of course, is right on the boundary line for Wearmouth. Bill Della's given all these free kicks so far. And now he runs round on the angle. Well, you wouldn't believe what happened then. As that boy, Ronnie Wearmouth, was positioned correctly on the boundary line. He only had one player on the mark. And he was allowed to run around to a much better... He came in at least 10 yards or 10 metres and put it through for a goal. And Neil Kerley, you wouldn't believe that could happen. That Richmond backs would have let that in.
Oh, that was a shocking defensive error. That, you know, that's just inexperience and bad error.
All right, was a goal to Wearmouth. 12 minutes gone. Richmond 2-2, Collingwood 2-2.
Lee wins it out of the centre, gave it to Mervyn Keane, but Kane's deemed to be holding the ball on a tackle by Olsen. Olsen in the centre of the ground for Collingwood to score 2-2 each. 2-2-14 each team on the 3W Greater Melbourne scoreboard. And it's Olsen kicking down through centre-half forward up to the last line of defence. It was taken by Malthouse. He hand-passed to Bourke, and Bourke's kick is smothered very effectively by Craig Davis, or Stewart. Stewart coming across there in the path of the ball. So 2-2 each at the 14-minute mark into the first quarter of the 1980 Grand Final. Boundary umpire whipping it back into play. At the back, it was Mount who got the ball down. I'm sure of that. It went to Kink. Kink was holding the ball. Play on was the call. No, he was tackled, and it's the free kick is going to Malthouse. Playing on quickly, getting it up towards the centre of the ground. Lee is high, stretched high, knocked the ball further up towards centre-half court. Look at Bartlett out facing Magro. Magnificent football, but it's gone to Jess. Jess ran into a strong tackle. Could not be holding the ball, surely. And the free kick's gone against Jess, and it's going to Collingwood's Andy Ireland, who withstood the blast as Jess came through. Ireland now getting up towards centre-half back to kick it to the outer side of the ground. They're flying high. Was knocked down, tapped down by Roach. Wood was high too. Picked up by Wearmouth. Intercepted by Waitman. Raines, he spins out of the pack and kicks to the half-forward line. But Byrne is in the way. Takes the mark and hand passes to Carlton. Carlton has a bounce as he hits centre wing position. Then steadies and gets onto his left foot to kick over towards centre-half forward. Morris in the middle of a pack and low. And knocked it down. Picked up by Olsen. Olsen onto the left foot. Kicks it to the member side of the ground up towards the forward pocket, picked up eventually by Stewart. A hand pass to Ray Shaw, a magnificent smother by Mount, still up on the half forward line, and eventually it's gone over the line. And it was great defense by Richmond there. 15 minutes into the quarter, each team is 2-2, and the boundary umpire positioning himself on the member side of the ground on half forward flank for Collingwood. Into the air it goes, and knocked away by several players down to Ray Shaw. He steadies and shoots for goal, and it's going to be through. I think it's a goal. Hit the post. Hit the post. Well, Collingwood showed their best glimpses of form in the last 2 or 3 minutes, and they've hit the front on 2 goals, 3:15, leading Richmond 2-2-14, coming towards the 16-minute mark in the first quarter.
Francis Bourke boots it out there towards the centre. It's over centre half back. It's a long kick, and there's nearly a mark. No to Dunn. He didn't pay it. Wearmouth fumbled. He got one in the back. Umpire said it'll be a baller. But it was nearly a mark to Dunn that time, Bob.
Did look that way, Lou, but we'll see how consistent they are at making the players really hold them.
Back it goes again. Knocked out by Stewart. A beautiful knockout. Rene King trying to burst through the pack, but this is Wood coming out at centre half back. The ball back towards Richmond centre half forward position. Picked up by Waitman out to Bartlett on his gun. He looks dangerous as he hooks the ball out wide. He's gone for short pass to Jess. And Jess has played on foolishly that time. Put Welsh under pressure, but he gets away nicely from Magro. The ball up there towards the full forward position. There's Roach at the back. The ball pushed out by Moore. Scooped away again by Morris. And the ball is out of bounds about 30 metres around from the Richmond goal. Collingwood at the moment 2-3-15 to Richmond 2-2-14. 16 minutes gone of the first quarter. Lee got a knockout but not a good one. It's finally pushed out to Bart. This looks dangerous on the boundary line. A goal coming up. It's a goal. Beautiful goal by Marvel. He's giving the victory sign as he runs past there with a fist in the air. 17 minutes gone, and Richmond go to the front now. They're 3 goals, 2:20 to Collingwood at the moment, 2 goals, 3:15.
We watch again on replay, and we find Kevin Morris nowhere near Kevin Bartlett. Wherever Bartlett goes, Morris has to make sure that Bartlett is sort of, that Morris is between Bartlett and the goals.
17 minutes gone on the first term, 20 plays 15, 5 points the difference. Moore and Lee, Peter Moore with a big fist to it, down towards right half forward. Chance for Kink to pick the ball up. Mount tries to grab him, but he's too fast and too big. Kink, hand pass out okay. Young fires at the goals. Is it a quick answer for Collingwood? I think not. And through for only one behind. So that makes the difference. 4 points now in the first quarter, 20 plays 16.
And Mickey Malthouse has the ball, and we wait for him to kick the ball back into play after 18 and a half minutes of play.
I think Richmond's height is having an effect on the play, particularly down on the forward line. They're making Collingwood stretch a lot. It's Malthouse kicking over towards the member side of the ground. It's knocked away. A chance for Wiley. Wiley runs back into the back line before hand passing. He's given it to Malthouse, who taps it further afield, withstanding a strong tackle, and eventually it's gone over the line out of bounds. It's in the forward pocket territory for Collingwood, attacking up towards the punt road end. And 19 minutes into the term, they trail by 4 points. Richmond 3-2 and Collingwood 2-4 on the 3RW Greater Melbourne scoreboard. The boundary umpire getting it back into play now. The rucks lean on each other, and Dunn got it down, but it was intercepted by Weirmouth. A quick hand pass to Craig Davis over towards the boundary line, and Welch assists in pushing it over the line. Still in Collingwood's forward pocket, about 15 metres around from the behind post, still favouring the members' side of the ground. We've hit 20 minutes into the first term, and the ball comes back into play again. Knocked away. Stewart had the first tap, but it went down quickly to Malthouse. He kicks up towards the centre wing position, members' side of the ground. Lee, he's tapping it back. He's done it effectively two or three times. Gave it to Jess. Jess kicks to the half forward line. Morris indulges a bit of tapping and gave it to Magro. Magro ducked into the tackle, and the free kick is holding the ball against him. Picked up very quickly by Waitman. Hand passes to Raines. Raines kicks high up to the forward line, and Cloak had half a bite of the cherry then. He had a grab but didn't quite sustain it, and it was pushed through by a relieved Collingwood defence for 1 point. And Richmond have moved on to 3-3-21 and Collingwood at 2-4-16. McCormick kicking it back into play, and straight upfield he goes. Wood there was high. They're reeling in the air, Richmond. Down to the ground it goes. It came out through Raines to Wood again into the pack of players, and the umpire has decided to bounce at centre-half forward for the Tigers as they go up towards the railway or scoreboard end. The Richmond score is 3-3 and Collingwood is 2-4 as the bounce, and Lee thumps it away out to the outer side of the ground. Wood beating his man over there. Has got it under control. Hand passes back to Kane. And Kane's long shot for goal is through for a goal in brilliant sunshine. Kane kicked it long, and Richmond playing the long game to perfection and looking good in the air have gone on to 4 goals 3-27, Collingwood 2-4-16, and that goal came up 20 minutes and 30 seconds into the first term.
Right, back up there to Frank Considine. Things aren't looking good for Collingwood.
No, but what an amazing kick by Merv Keane then. Just roosted onto the boot. He appeared as though it was only going to be a pass, but the result, a beautiful goal.
Yes, big one there for the Tigers. They're getting away at the 21-minute mark. They've got a lead of 11 points. As in comes umpire Dell. It's another perfect bounce, and up they go, and Lee's winning the ruck, and that's where I think they're winning. The big decisive punch out again, but it's going to be picked up by Olsen. Olsen's kick is not good. It gives a chance for Stephen Mount to come through. He almost knocks his own teammate down, but he follows up and takes the pass. And he hand passes it over to Wiley. Wiley sees a lead up here, and it's out of bounds. He was trying to give it to Roach, and Roach was in front then of McCormick, but the ball's gone out of bounds to be thrown in. Now we wait and see what takes place here. Lee has gone back out of the ruck to take a rest, but Peter Moore's still in there. He's got to do the ruck work here. Of course, on that half-forward line for Collingwood, we note that up there, Craig Stewart goes for the tap out. Well, Moore takes it away. He's going to try and get a run. He can't do that. He runs a little way, then kicks it long. Raines can't take the mark, but it's going to ball. The ball will run for him nicely. He gets up toward the half-back line, and then from centre-half-back, kicks it out to the centre-wing position. Certainly, Jess will take the mark. Barham's not fit at all. Barham is worrying about his leg as the ball comes out to Strawn. Strawn to centre-half-forward, and then up go Roach, trying to tap out toward Bartlett. Doesn't find him. In goes Morrison, taps it out nicely. Going to be picked up by Dacos. Dacos will go for a hand pass to Ray Shaw, and Roach is still running to try and tackle to keep the pressure on, and Weirmouth in front. Punched away by Mick Malthouse, back toward Jess. Jess with a left-handed hand pass. Oh, was trying to find his teammate and Mount. Mount got it under control nicely. Gave it to Strawn. Strawn of Richmond down. Oh, where King should have taken that mark. Let it go through his fingers. Came out toward Wiley. Wiley kicks it long, and up goes Cloak, and it's too strong for Andy Ireland. Great move by Coach Stew. He's got Cloak. He's got a two-barreled attack down there. Two giants of men, particularly Cloak and Roach, playing alongside each other. Cloak takes this one. He's 15 metres out from goal. He's directly in front. He couldn't miss it, but I think he may have. He has. He's missed from 15 metres out directly in front of the Jollymont end. And that's a let off for Collingwood there. As at the 23 and a half minute mark, McCormick waits for the ball to come back. Richmond a 4-4-28 and Collingwood a 2-4-16. As we get a quick comment from Neil Kerley.
Richmond have certainly taken control of the game in the last 10 minutes. Collingwood got to be more desperate. I thought Kink should have controlled that ball, but he didn't. He didn't go after it hard enough. And Richmond are looking good all over the ground.
All right, Tommy Lahiff, a comment from you.
Well, the Tigers are winning in the air in their pace, and I think Lee's been able to get on top of more from the centre bounces, and they're making better use of the ball. They're running Collingwood a bit ragged at present. They lack pace.
OK, a new ball coming back in here. One of the crowd has got a souvenir out there, one of the 118,000-odd people that are here today.
McCormick coming up to the line to kick the ball back into play, and he's gone right down the centre of the ground, or towards the centre. Lee is in front. It's thumped away by Carlson. 15 metres upfield. Mount comes in. He's a strong player. Gets it under control. Tackle might have been too high. It's the way the umpire read it too, and Mount will get the free kick close to the centre of the ground, slightly favouring the outer side. And Mount comes up for Richmond and boots the ball long, looking over there for Cloak. Cloak's in front of Ireland. Jackknifes into the air, but he's knocked it down to Smith, and Smith comes past strongly for Richmond, hooks it up towards Roach. McCormick knocked it away from that player down to the ground to be picked up by Morris in the back pocket, and Morris kicks it further upfield, and the mark is taken by Dacos on the half back line, ranging across the half back line slightly towards centre half back. He's kicked long up beyond the centre of the ground, going to the punt road end. Mount knocked the ball away. It's hit the ground. A chance here for Collingwood, and they'll take the ball away with hand passing from Davis to Wearmouth. Wearmouth is headed towards the member side of the ground. Had one bounce. He's in trouble. Didn't know what to do until he got the call from Davis. Davis breaks the tackle. They're still on the half forward line. Whips it back with the left foot, and he can kick anything from there over towards Kink, and Kink's knocked it through for a point. One behind only. Collingwood fiddled on their half forward line then for a little while, and they lost momentum as a result of doing so, but they've gone on to 2-5-17 and they trail Richmond 4-4-28 as we come up towards the 25 minute mark into the first quarter. Waiting for the ball to come back into play, and it'll be Malthouse to kick the ball back in for Richmond. He's kicked to the member side on most occasions, but it's this time it's Bourke kicking the ball in and driving across to the outer side of the ground. High there was Stewart. It went to the ground. A chance for Young. He couldn't control it. Wood goes in. Hand passes to Rowlings, but he took too long and threw it, and the free kick will go to Collingwood and be taken by its captain in Ray Shaw, and it'll be a 15-metre penalty against Richmond now. Dangerous position. Now brings Shaw within kicking distance. He's down in the attacking side of the half-forward flank on the outer side of the ground. He's taking plenty of time about it. He's measuring the distance as he fiddles with his socks. Wood stands the mark and glares, and Shaw, that's Ray Shaw, the Collingwood captain, lining them up with his team trailing by 11 points at the 25 and a half minute mark in the term. He comes in to put the kick on its way, and it's a good kick, but hit the post.
He did it twice.
Hit the post twice, Collingwood.
Ray Shaw both times.
And Collingwood have gone on to 2-6. So they've had 8 scoring shots each. Richmond are on 4-4-28 and Collingwood 2-6-18. So on the score of shots alone, it's been even. But the odds favour Richmond at this early stage of the game. Now Bourke kicking in over to the outer side of the ground, looking there for Wood. Didn't find him, but Rowlings pounces on the ball to bring it back into play. A slick hand pass there nearly went astray to Raines, and he's got to come in and do it again. Rowlings, he does. Slaps it onto the left foot, gets it to Kane. Kane to Wood is good handball. Wood for further upfield to Waitman. He's clear. He's breaking loose with a bounce. They'll have another one if he wants it, but he doesn't. Reaches half forward flank, kicks long, looking for Cloak, and finds him. Runs into the open goal. He's missed it. Cloak marked the ball in the square, ran on, hooked it back to his left, and it went through between goal and behind post. It was ridiculous. He's missed two now, and Richmond could have had 6 or 7 goals on the board, but for this shocking inaccuracy. As it is, they're 4-5 to 2-6, and McCormick comes up to the line again to kick long down towards the centre of the ground, and Lee thumps it away. Into the pack goes Raines and comes out, kicks up towards full forward. Roach was knocking it down looking for Bartlett. Might have been nearly kicking in danger. Shaw let one go as he came through. Hand passes out to Ireland. Shaw wants to fight Roach, and it's gone over the line out of bounds, and Shaw and Magro more intent on whacking Roach than intent on the ball. Left forward pocket for Richmond on the outer side of the ground, into the time on period as the ball's thrown back into play. Roach now jackknifing in, so too did Moore, knocked it to the ground and knocked it into the pack of players there, out to Ray Shaw, and he'll take the ball away from the back pocket.
And Shaw does that for Collingwood, out toward the outer side. Up goes Carlson in front. Woods following up strongly, and so too is Jess. Jess gets hold of it for Richmond.
left foot right down toward Roach, punched away from that player by Peter Moore, goes to ground, is a chance for sure, he's foxing, and the ball goes out of bounds. Well, the big strength of Cloak. He's going to be a very dangerous player if he gets his kicking boot on. He's missed two sitters so far. He's going to take the ruck work against Moore. Moore taps it away from him. It goes to Jess. Jess of Richmond, hand passing the ball back, and does it nicely toward Kane. Kane goes up, and at the back is the big mark after the Kane kick by Roach again, up over the top of McCormick. And Roach's mark, and he is only 9 metres out from goal, and he's directly in front. Now, he's already missed an easy one after a free, and we know that Cloak has missed two easy ones. Surely he couldn't possibly miss this one. And he's 9 metres out from goal. Comes in. No, he hasn't missed this one. He's put it straight through the centre. And at the 28-minute mark, Richmond go further ahead on the 3RW Greater Melbourne Building Society scoreboard. They're outmarking Collingwood. Richmond are 5-5-35, and Collingwood are 2-6-18. And we've been playing exactly 28 and a half minutes as we get further comments. Rex Hunt.
They're playing the long game to perfection, and with their two key forwards, they're playing in front of Collingwood. Collingwood have tremendous problems now because they have no one with strength to combat Cloak or Roach.
It's a great move down there by Tony Jules. I said very early, of having Cloak and the Roach playing alongside each other. Very big men, and Cloak, of course, a giant of a man. In goes umpire Robinson, bounced the ball up over Peter Moore. He didn't get it across to Kink. Kink won't come in, and that allowed Raines to go and pick the ball up. Kink's going to have to fight his way back into the game. And there's a free kick coming up against Rowlings down here, and that'll be taken by Ray Byrne. Byrne of Collingwood to take the free kick. Rowlings being told to come back on the mark. It's on the outer side. Up goes Mount, tries to tap it away. Oh, almost a great tackle there on Raines. In goes Kink, trying to push himself in. A duck by Kane, didn't come off. It went out toward Moore. Moore goes for a hand pass to Byrne. The ball doesn't bounce the right way. In goes Wood. Wood has to hand pass the ball quickly into no man's territory. Following up nicely is Carlson. Carlson kicks with the left boot. Jess again in front has got the ball moving nicely up toward the half-forward line, kicked off the ground by Morris. Collingwood aren't handling the ball well. Carlson takes it nicely. There's a chance for Shaw. Misses an easy mark. Ball's been dropped down there by Mount, but play on call the umpire. And the umpire now, umpire Della, coming in to bounce the ball. Umpire Della bouncing the ball on almost the half-forward, between the centre wing and the half-forward flank position for the Tigers, have done well in this quarter. And up goes Lee again. You can see him out reaching Peter Moore, but he punches it straight to Magro. Magro calling it up toward the half forward line. No one home. In goes Craig Davis. Grab when not in possession. Hand pass the ball on, but it's all the Tigers. They're far too big and strong. Francis Burke gets hold of it, puts it out towards Strawn. He's another giant of a man. And then it comes toward the centre wing position. Here's Raines on his own out here on the member stand side of the ground. He goes for a kick, but it's again Kink missing an easy mark. The ball goes through his hands. Picked up again by Wiley, and it's going through. It's a goal, all right. Yes, a good goal by Wiley, and all because Raines was allowed to get on his own out here on the centre wing position, and Richmond are running all over Collingwood at this stage. Richmond, at the 31-minute mark, are 6-5-41 to Collingwood 2-6-18, as we get another comment from Polly Perkins.
Yes, at this stage, I think the region of Richmond are in front. They're winning right across their centre line. They're giving a lot of drive, and Jess at centre half forward has already put them in the game.
OK, Jess, that move up to centre half forward has been a winner as well. They've got winners everywhere. Collingwood's got a lot of problems. Up goes the ball, and Mark Lee and Peter Moore go together. Neither player won it out of the centre then. Dacos goes in for Collingwood, kicks it with the left boot, but who's down there? It's all Dunn. Dunn goes up the second bite of the cherry. Missed it. No, he's been paid. He's been paid a free kick being grabbed after he couldn't get his hands to it for the second grab. So it's coming down toward Barham. Barham down the ground again. Siren sounding. I think Barham will have to come off. Barham has got a big problem. He's worried anyhow, and he's calling to the doctor to come over and see him. And after the first stanza, Richmond taking all points with eight. Is their best kick getter. Ray Shaw's got six, and Lee's had 11 hit outs to Peter Moore's five. As in moves umpire Ian Robinson to bounce the ball, and up this should suit Moore. Moore, that's a tap out, all right. It's coming over now towards Stewart. Stewart with the long hand pass to Craig Davis. Tap it over. They couldn't do so, and Malthouse charged up, and Malthouse took the ball away from Craig Davis, kicked it wide over to Jess. and Jess is leading, picking a merry dance. That's part of the tactics. Back it goes from the kick by Jess, right down towards the forward pocket area. It's dangerous. In goes Bartlett, misses the run of the ball. It's going to be picked up in that last line of defence. This time by McCormick. McCormick's got it moving, and Jess has got up high again, over Pickin to take the mark. Now Pickin doesn't like to be run around a lot, and Jess is doing that. The fourth mark to Jess as he comes in and kicks a ripper right down toward the teeth of goals. They fly high. Roaches up. He doesn't mark it. Play on call. The umpire was cloak up there. He thinks he's got the mark. He didn't have it. First touch, according to umpire Della, was in front. Cloak coming from behind. And the ball is about to be bounced right in the teeth of goals for the Richmond team. Up went Peter Moore. He tapped it down all right. And a free kick to Collingwood. Collingwood picking the free kick up here. Looks like little Magro, is it? It's going to pick himself. No, it'll be Morris. Morris is picking himself up, and Kevin Bartlett stands the mark at the punt road end. And that's a let out for Collingwood there. Up goes Wood in front of Carlson. He's too big for him. And Wood gets up right in front and takes a clear-cut, clean mark. He's on the member stand side, the northern stand side of the ground. Used to be known as Olympic Stand. And he's on the half-forward line. Wood's a pretty good kick of a football. He'd be something like 50-odd metres out from goal, but he could make the distance. Punt road end. No, it's going to go a torpedo punt off the side of the boot. But look at Cloak getting up. And Cloak fires through the air. And he's got another one on the chest. Oh, brother, has he got strength, this fellow. He flew high then. You could, in the call, you could tell he was going to mark it. He was flying through the air. And with his big frame, the players in front were moving out from the weight of his bulk of his body. And he's kicked this one. He was only 15 metres out from goal, and he put it through, and he was pleased because he's missed two of the easiest goals you'd see ever. And now Cloak, once he gets on the ball, there'll be problems, because that was a real strength mark, and there was no other word for that mark, Neil Kerley. That's all you could say, real strength.
Well, of course, he's got a bit of bulk on his size, but he made a direct line at the ball, and it's amazing when big players make a direct approach to the ball. There always seems to be a gap there.
Well, he forced the gap on that occasion with the players in front of him, and that's a third strong chest mark. I think that might be rather ominous. The score here on 3LW Greater Melbourne scoreboard, Richmond are 7-5-47 and Collingwood 2-6-18.
Well, to quote the oft used phrase, they're in more trouble than the early settlers, Collingwood. They're in heaps of it. As the umpire puts the ball down, Moore and Moore and Lee and Moore won it. He got it up towards Collingwood's half forward line. Welsh came across there, went to Davies, who flipped it out, or Davis flipped it out to Dacos. Dacos kicks deep into the forward pocket, but Mickey Malthouse, a strong player who's letting everyone know that he's around, has taken the mark. He's in the right back pocket for Richmond, defending at the scoreboard end, and Malthouse comes up from the back pocket to kick it out towards the half back line. And in front there is Mount, and Mount has marked for Richmond. They're doing it on the bit, Richmond, at the present moment. Mount's kick is in towards the centre of the ground. Jess was high there. Rowlings comes in to help. Taken away by Rayburn. A hand pass out to Weymouth. That tackle must have been too high. Play on is the call on Rowlings. And it came out to Waitman. Waitman back to Rowlings with handball. And across to Kane. Further handball. Kane's lined him up. And he's kicked his second goal. That's two goals to Kane. And there's something going on behind play. They're wrestling and fighting and scrimmaging on the ground. Pickin wants to fight. And so too does Welsh in there. But the scoreboard, the 3AW Greater Melbourne scoreboard, shows that Richmond are clear winners at the present moment. Teammates come in to push Welsh out of the way, and umpire Robinson speaks to him. The score is Collingwood Richmond 8-5-53. They're romping away from Collingwood 2-6-18, and that's just the difference between the teams. 35 points, and Richmond are that much better at the moment, not only on the board, on the ground, on everywhere. And Collingwood want to fight. Well, it's back into the centre of the ground. Della marching away from the circle, waiting for players to cool down and get into their positions. Moore and Lee are both 15 metres back from the circle. As Della moves in, has a chat to Wiley, who's played pretty well incidentally and is prepared to trade bumps with anybody, and Della comes to the circle. Now he slaps it down, and Lee is first to arrive and thumps it away up to Jess, and he gives it another thump upfield. Waitman likewise. It reaches centre half forward. They're going in hard, but eventually it'll be picked up and Collingwood come out of trouble. Through Olsen up towards centre half forward, knocked back to Jimmy Jess, who could have taken it, but Lee comes in, a magnificent athlete, gets it under control, fires it out towards Bartlett on the half forward line. Bartlett now has controlled the ball and he's whipped it back over towards Cloak, but it's going to be too far for the big fellow, I think. The goal umpire signals it's out of bounds,
The field umpire sees the signal. The boundary umpire is a long way behind. And the free kick will go to Collingwood and be taken by Ireland at the 5-minute mark in the second quarter.
Did anyone see what took place in that incident there at all? None of our boys say what took place. And we see the ball by Ireland going out wide, but he's been told to go back and kick over the mark. And so the ball does go back. You didn't see it, Rex?
I saw nothing.
You saw nothing. You're saying nothing too. Well, we might say the player settled down again, and the ball kicked down toward Peter Moore, knocked away by Mark Lee, coming back toward Magro. Magro's trap. But he copped one a bit high. He copped one a bit high from that first tackle across the face. And back it goes toward Jess, trying to outmark his own teammate. But up goes Billy Pickin. And Pickin from behind has got a touch of the ball and has got the mark. And that might give him a little more confidence. And that's what Collingwood need now, as the ball comes down, looking almost to mark the Strawn. Can't quite take it. Goes to Davis of Collingwood. He gets onto the right boot and kicks it back up toward Lowe. Lowe's foxing for the position. But he's outnumbered there. He's completely, not only outnumbered, but he's outreached. Because Dunn of Richmond would be 6'7" or 6'6", and Lowe would be lucky to be 5'11". Woolnough's going to come onto the field. Up goes Emmett Dunn, gets an easy tap out, goes to Young. Young puts it through from behind for Collingwood, and at the 6-minute mark into the second quarter, Collingwood really struggling, and the score, Collingwood 2-7-19, Richmond 8-5-53 on 3LW Greater Melbourne scoreboard. And here comes Francis Burke to kick the ball back into play on this occasion. He's possibly looking for Mount, but Mount's on this side of the ground, so he goes to the outer side and is kicking over there to Emmett Dunn. He's outnumbered over there, and Collingwood will take the mark, all right. Collingwood take the mark. That's Ricky Barham. Barham's hand pass is not all that good. It's gone over towards Craig Stewart. He's tackled hard. In it goes to Ray Shaw. Lines him up from an angle. He's put it through, I think. He looked pretty happy about it. Yes, it's through a goal. Ray Shaw was on his way back to the centre. He knew it was a goal. So did the goal umpire. And after 7 minutes of play, Collingwood get that desperate goal they needed. And Richmond still lead, and lead well, as we see Ricky Barham coming off. He's broken down in the first minutes of play. Can't use his pace at all to advantage, and Woolnough coming on. Richmond 8 goals, 5.53. Collingwood a 3.7.25 on the 3LW Greater Melbourne Building Society scoreboard. Barham would be very upset as Woolnough goes onto the ground. He won't be able to get onto the other side, I wouldn't think. Oh, yeah, the ball's, he's got a chance, because the ball is on its way back now. Let's get a quick comment from Rex Hunt.
Well, Richmond are too strong in every department. I don't think Collingwood has a clear winner, although Ray Shaw is playing particularly well. Richmond playing the long game, have two magnificent spearheads, and they are certainly dominating the game at this stage.
All right, back into the centre. Welsh coming up to Woolnough. Woolnough's been a pretty useful player for Collingwood in this final series. Kicked a magnificent goal in one of the games. It thumped away by Lee up towards centre-half forward, taken under control there by Stewart up there on the back line. It picked up by Raines out of the centre, kicking long up towards a full forward spot. Big Richmond men up there. They're both on the ground now, cloak and ropes, and the umpire will go in and bounce in the goal square.
Craig Stewart playing at centre-half back, and Billy Pickin centre-half forward for Collingwood in a move by Tom Hafey. Barham's off, and Woolnough to the wing.
3LW Greater Melbourne scoreboard. Richmond 8-5-53, Collingwood 3-7-25. The bounce is affected, and what's going to happen? There's a free kick to Collingwood, and it's going to go to Peter Moore. He's right on the goalpost as he comes up out of the back pocket area to take his kick. Cloak standing the mark, and Moore's kick is a shocker. That's spinning out towards the half-back line for Collingwood. Off the head of the pack, Carlson, desperate, kicks it off the ground. Into the centre, Young of Collingwood misses an easy mark. Francis Burke came in. He's tackled. The ball's knocked away from him. Down to the ground it goes. Smith wrestling desperately down there for Richmond. Into a seething pack of players there. And umpire Robinson is going to bounce it. 5 or 6 metres away from the centre circle, favouring the outer side of the ground. That's 30 or 28 points the difference favouring Richmond. Lee thumps it out of the centre. He's murdering Moore in the ruck. It's gone up towards the half-forward line. Collingwood are able to take it away through Woolnough, kicking up towards centre-half forward. At the back was Mount. He knocks it into the centre. Picked up by Kane. Hand passing brilliantly to Waitman. Waitman whips it back to Wood, who's having a birthday, but he fumbled that one. And the Collingwood captain, who's their best player, comes in and gets it under control, gets clapped for the effort, and it was a great effort. Kicks it around towards the member side of the ground. And Pickin has ridden over the line. Holding the ball is a call by Robinson against Pickin. On Collingwood's half-forward line, a strong tackle by Mount.
Mount at half-back for Richmond. Richmond are 53 points to 25. And Mount kicks out of the back line up towards the centre wing. Lee tried to knock it further afield. Shaw kicked it, was tackled strongly by Raines. And the free kick is going to go further upfield to Carlton. For a penalty free kick against Raines for knocking Shaw to the ground after he kicked the ball. At centre wing, and it's Carlson kicking in towards centre half forward. Stewart up on the forward line, gets it out to Wearmouth. Richmond's tackling is strong. Wearmouth's kicked into the pocket, giving Olsen a chance, but he had a look. There's no doubt about it. He's running into trouble, and he faked the free kick. No way in the world. Robinson fell for that one, and Olsen gets up very quickly. He's got the free kick in the forward pocket on the member side of the ground. It's about 30 metres out from goal on probably a 60 to 65 degree angle. Richmond 8-5 to 3-7, and Olsen lines them up. It's not a bad looking kick, but swung right away, and it's gone over the line out of bounds as far as Richmond are concerned. It's poetic justice, and the free kick will go to Dunn of Richmond.
Incidentally, David Young's been sent back to pick up Jess, and Craig Stewart's come back onto the forward line.
Dunn from the back pocket on the outer side of the ground, kicking it long up towards his team's half back line. Lee flips it out again. It's gathered in by Welsh. Welsh drives beyond centre wing, leading in as Wiley, and Wiley's run the ball over the line on centre wing, or getting up towards the half forward line on that outer side of the ground. And a wrestle going on behind play. Ooh. With Jess. Yeah. Ooh. I saw it too, with Jess backing back towards his opponent in Young, and they're pushing and shoving and jostling. The scoreboard is 8-5 to 3-7. Back into play, and Moore can't handle the ball at all. It's gone to the ground, picked up very quickly there by Shaw, and Shaw kicks it out to see the mark taken by Malthouse on the centre wing position outer side.
Well, Malthouse for Richmond, kicking down toward that centre forward position, and a free kick against Collingwood's low. That would be Morris for trying to stop Big Mark Lee. Oh, here's a chance now for Bartlett. He's let out. There'll be a 15-metre penalty here against Macro. Macro will get a 15-metre penalty against him. He's knocked Bartlett after he's got after he's taken the mark. And Macro, the second bad error by Macro in his anxiety to tackle players after the ball has gone on. And Bartlett not only takes the mark, a 15-metre penalty, 2 metres out from goal, didn't miss, put it through, 12 minutes gone, and Richmond's got its ninth goal on the board, and Bartlett's his second. 9 goals, 5, a total of 59 to Collingwood, 3 goals, 7, 25, and certainly, Tommy, it looks as though Collingwood a little rattled.
Very badly rattled, Harry, and I don't think they can do anything at present, because Lee is dominating all over the ground. He's getting the ball out. Richmond are making good use of it. They're passing the ball. Well, that was a beautiful pass of Lee's to Bartlett, and a bad mistake by Magro resulted in a 15-metre penalty.
Okay, the ball back in the centre with umpire Ian Robinson, and he's coming in to bounce the ball. Pretty tough tackling here. Barham going off, and he's really limping badly now. That was one move that didn't come off. Up goes Lee again, and he outreaches Peter Moore yet again, and going through hard was Young. He missed the run of it, and Morris is able for Collingwood to save this attack by taking the mark at centre-half back. He kicks out wide. He's trying to find Pickin. Pickin takes the mark on the chest. Got to keep the ball moving. Moving much faster. He doesn't do so. He goes back to take a set kick. There it is. That one of those wobbly sort of punt kicks. Up towards centre-half forward. Kink can't get in the game. Trying to mark it one-handed. And in the back goes the Richmond. I thought that was in the back, and I thought that's the way he played it. But Olsen is getting the free kick. Thought that was the signal then. And Olsen for Collingwood to take this free kick. And he's on the half-forward line, and Collingwood are desperate for a goal. They badly need one. Umpire Della paying Olsen the free kick here. Former Carlton player, torpedo punt, long kick, point. And there's no cheers at all, no joy for Collingwood behind the goals down there. And at the 14-minute mark, Richmond stay well in front. 9 goals, 5.59 on 3AW Greater Melbourne Building Society scoreboard. And Collingwood's score is 3.826. That's a 33 points difference, and Collingwood badly need goals and need them quickly.
Well, Bourke coming up to the line and directing play around the members' side of the ground. It's a strangely quiet crowd. It's hit the turf. Wood will come in, handled by Carlson there. Play on was a good call. Carlson goes in to try and get the ball out of the pack, but can't. And the umpire's going to bounce the ball on Collingwood's half forward line on the members' side of the ground. It's a little bit anti-climax at the moment, this game, with the difference 31 points or 33 points the difference. At the bounce, it was Lee winning it once again. Went down to Raines. Raines pushed it away. Threw it away pretty well, I thought. It went out to Moore of Collingwood.
Collingwood. He's dropped it like a hot cake and he ran away. He knew he'd be committed the sin, and now the free kick will go to Kane of Richmond. There's not a weak player on the Richmond team. They're all putting in one way or the other. It's Kane coming up to the half back line and directing it across towards the outer side of the ground. In front there was McCormick. It went down to Woolnough. Woolnough a bit slow to get rid of the ball. Eventually got his kick into the centre. Dacos strangely quiet. Oh, and evaded the tackles pretty well. It goes to ground to be picked up by Olsen. Beautiful interception by Smith. And Smith has kicked to Bartlett. And Bartlett is marked on the half forward line on the outer side of the ground. Morris is upfield and he rushed back. You could see how frantic he was as he rushed back towards Bartlett, who'd taken the mark. And the little fellow, a former teammate of his, is now going to line them up from 40 metres out, perhaps 40 metres, maybe a little bit less, on a 45 degree angle, and it's spinning in right. It's a goal. It's a third one to Bartlett, and he raises his arms and punches holes in the air, and Richmond have gone on a 10-5 or 9-5-59. 9-5-59, they lead Collingwood, a bedraggled Collingwood on 3-8-26. It's got to be 10-5, that's what I call, and the board was a little slow then. 10-5-65 to 3-8-26.
Well, Neil Kerley, you said earlier that Morris had to come away from Bartlett.
Well, he just doesn't check in close enough for a halfback. Bartlett, you've got to have a player on Bartlett just sticks real close, and Morris not doing that.
Okay, well, there's Lee. He taps the ball out to Raines. Raines with a hand pass over to Wood. Wood gives it to Wiley. Wiley to Rowlings, and it's through for a point. And well, one Collingwood player got a sniff of the ball then. That was great stuff, but Lee took that ball out then. It was a bad bounce, and it was very easy for them to move the ball around, but they are looking really good. And one wonders whether this great grand final that we anticipated is going to come off. The kick in that comes right down toward Young. Young hand passes the ball back to Carlson. Carlson at the centre-half back position, kicks long up toward Craig Stewart. Can't take the mark toward Pickham. The ball's bouncing for Woolnough. Won't bounce the right way. Craig Stewart's moving up again. Will hand pass the ball back to Olsen. Olsen eludes a tackle. Punches it out wide to Woolnough. They're not grabbing it surely. He better pass it quickly. He does to Pickham. Round the neck to Pickham. Round the neck by Malthouse. And Pickham takes the free kick. He's about 55 metres out, and what's more, he's on an angle. Well, they say when you do kick for goal, players do all sorts of things. Malthouse has come back 10 metres. He's running up to there. There's a line out there. And if Billy goes over it, he'll find himself in trouble because Malthouse is allowed to run up. He's coming up now. There's Billy Pickham. It's a torpedo punt. It's a point. It didn't look too good as he kicked it, but that was another free for around the neck. He gets a lot of those, Bill Pickham, but that one was definitely a too high tackle, and he's playing at centre half forward. As in comes Francis Burke to kick the ball in for the Richmond team. Up goes Mark Lee, trying to mark it one hand. Come on, Renee Kink, you've got to get into the play. It comes down toward Davis. Davis with the right foot. He's hit the post again. They've hit the post three times, Collingwood. That's bad luck. Davis has hit the post. And this is very bad luck for Collingwood because, to say the least, it's got to be unlucky to hit the post, and they've done it on three occasions, Ray Shaw twice, and now Craig Davis. As we see the scoreboard, Collingwood 3 goals, 10, 28 on 3AW Greater Melbourne Building Society scoreboard, and Richmond 10, 6, 66.
Burke kicks into the member side of the ground, coming from behind as Wood at the back. He knocked it down, recovers well, scoops it out towards Rowlings, and Rowlings picks up expertly, passes just as expertly to Wiley, and Wiley marks. Wiley, in an unobtrusive fashion, has been doing very well for Richmond. He's passed into the centre of the ground to Smith. Smith takes the mark and drives it up towards centre-half forward. The big men fly there, and literally they flew. It came to Ireland. Ireland got a hand pass out to Morris, and Morris kicks to Carlson. Carlson marks centre wing on the member side of the ground. It's 20 minutes into the second term, and it's 10-6 to 3-10, with the Tigers doing it easily. Carlson kicks to the outer side of the ground, and Woolnough saw everyone looming up on his sights there and took a courageous mark. Welch was the player that loomed up, and Woolnough's got enough in him to get up and say, cop that. He's coming up towards the centre-half forward spot. He drops it into the centre-half forward spot, and Peter Moore is marked. Tackled by Lee, a great tackle, taken by Kane. Kane kicks to the outer side of the ground. Welch knocked it away. Woolnough, doing well, has got it again, but he was harassed there. It's gone a hand pass out to Dacos. Dacos, who's been beaten by Raines. Now he breaks past a tackle by Wiley, comes to centre-half forward, kicks in towards the full forward spot, and Kane is there to take the mark for Richmond. Richmond are just too strong in practically, in fact, every department on the ground, and their 10-6 to 3-10 is a true reflection on the state of the game. It's Kane near the goal line now and coming out from that position to kick to the member side of the ground, over towards Wood, off his hands it goes, Lee goes in and bumps anyone aside, picks it up and hand passes out to give Rowlings a chance to use his speed, but it went to Carlson. Carlson picks up on the half forward line for Collingwood on the member side, kicks into the forward pocket, several players go for possession of the ball and it's knocked over by Lowe in front of Bourke. On the 3RW Greater Melbourne scoreboard, it's Richmond 10-6 to Collingwood 3-10.
Right, the ball about to be thrown in. And up they go. There's a chance here for Collingwood. There's up goes Stewart. Comes down toward Olsen. Mount comes through strongly for Richmond. In goes Ronnie Wearmouth, being quiet. And well done, Richmond again. They tap it out toward Wiley. Wiley back to and Byrne had a chance. It goes off his hands over toward Wood. Wood taps it with a hand pass toward Rowlings. Rowlings trying to find Kevin Bartlett. He runs the ball over the boundary line, and the ball's about to be thrown in now. It's gone from Collingwood's forward pocket area up to the half-forward flank for the Richmond team. Richmond, strong, their tackling's fierce, and their players are not afraid to really put their bodies in. Up goes, this time, Big Mark Lee, gets it down toward Jess, comes toward Wearmouth. Wearmouth trying to tap it across, but he taps it straight to a Richmond player. They're smothered, the Collingwood players. It goes out towards Wiley. Wiley gave it to Bartlett. Bartlett lost the run of it for once. And now a hand pass to Woolnow. Woolnow would have been clear had he been able to get the run of the ball. Had to stop, take the kick. Up goes Pickett in front. Tries to mark. Can't do so. In goes Collingwood. Holding the man is the decision. And Collingwood will take the free kick through Russell Olsen. He's at centre half forward. And he's got to get the ball moving quickly. He's about to kick with the right foot. Down toward the full forward zone. It's all Richmond down there, reading it well with Shaw. Couldn't take it off the hands of the pack. In went Dacos. He's lost it. Goes back to Emmett Dunn. Here's a chance now for Wearmouth. He's slipping over. It's a critical time. Going in will be Kane. Kane with a hand pass over to Raines. The loose man's been created. In goes Welsh. Welsh is after it with one bounce, looking behind him. He's gone for two bouncer, and Bartlett loose again as Morris is caught in no man's land. And Bartlett is forced back and takes an easy mark. And can goal yet again. He's on the half-forward flank on that outer side, kicking down to the punt road end. In comes the kick by Bartlett, right up towards the teeth of goals. Cloaked a strong man there. Peter Moore says, I better punch it through. And he punched it through from behind. A rushed one for the Richmond side. And after 23 minutes of play, Richmond on the 3RW. Greater Melbourne Building Society scoreboard have control of the game on 10-7-67. Collingwood a 3-10-28. And Collingwood looking tentative.
McCormick coming up to the line and kicking it straight down towards the centre of the ground. Lee wrestles for possession there and position with Moore, and Lee gets the free kick. The Tigers are showing us just what 1980 football's all about, power plus, and they're doing it well, and Lee is dominating the game for mine. He's getting it out of the centre practically incessantly, and at centre half forward now, he'll kick the Tigers into attack. He ignores the lead from Bartlett, and this is a bad kick by Lee, but Bartlett's leading out into the pocket and marks in front of Morris. Bartlett is not as far out on this occasion as he was on the previous occasion about a minute ago. That's his fifth mark, Bartlett, which speaks volumes. It means he's in front and they're happy to pass to him as he leads up the ground. Now Bartlett on a 45 degree angle, kicking to the punt road end and probably 35 metres out, lining them up, a chance to kick his fourth goal, and that's exactly what he's done. He's kicked four, and Richmond are romping away. It's going to be interesting to see what this game brings forth, because right now it's a one horse race with Richmond on 11-7-73 over a rather shamefaced Collingwood 3-10-28.
Well, it is a disappointment. There's no doubt about that, because we all expected a great tussle here. Morris will be changed over. There's no doubt about that. And Byrne will go there, like everyone said before the game. But up will go Peter Moore and Mark Lee. Lee taps it out. The ball's not bouncing Collingwood's way either, incidentally. It's gone back to Wiley. Wiley with a hand pass over to Raines. Raines in turn toward Wood. Wood's bearing down the goals. Oh, great tackle, Magro. The beauty. And the free kick. We'll go to Magro. What a great tackle. He slipped over when he was about to tackle Wood. Wood was about to cleverly get around him. And from the ground, a diving position, he dived across and grabbed hold of Wood and takes the free kick, Magro, from that back pocket. Down toward Moore and Mark Lee. Mark Lee punched the way straight to Mervyn Keane. He's a prodigious kick, this fellow. He's kicked two mammoth goals so far, and this one just misses from about 65 metres out, and it's behind. Richmond are 11-8 now, a total of 74. Collingwood 3-10-28. 3AW Greater Melbourne Building Society scoreboard. Ball kicked in by Young.
And up towards the centre of the ground, and there's Kink coming into the game. He's been practically unsighted and he's taken a mark, and it's about time he got himself into the act if he possibly can. His kick is bad. It's gone into the centre of the ground, haphazard and wayward. Coming through strongly there is Strawn, and he taps it brilliantly to Waitman. Waitman looking for Bartlett, and it's gone through to Cloak. Cloak absolutely outpointed Andrew Ireland, using that huge frame of his to perfection, and he's taken the mark. We look right down the line of his kick, looking from our commentary position down towards the punt road end, and he's on a slight angle and maybe 25 metres out, but the angle is so slight there's no breeze to speak of, and he's kicked it through for, it looks like, another point. So he's off target, Cloak. Had he been on target, the game would have been over. It's pretty close to that anyhow, but one always remembers great recoveries. And certainly Collingwood will have to make one, because their score is 3-10-28 and Collingwood 11-9-75. Ball kicked back into play by McCormick.
McCormick trying to find Peter Moore. Moore can't get into the game. It comes back toward Ireland and Cloak. Cloak's very strong. However, it's gone back toward McCormick. Now here's a chance for Roach. Kicks off the ground point. Behind to Roach. Being minded very closely down there. And here we have Magro and Bartlett wanting to get involved. And they are involved. Magro has grabbed hold of Bartlett, and they're trying to settle it quietly. Ian Robinson standing there telling Magro, be careful.
He'd want to be careful with Kevin too.
And Kevin Bartlett is not too happy about things at the moment. Magro playing him very, very closely. And Magro's been asked to pick up Bartlett. Bartlett's telling the players to get it away, move on. McCormick comes in to kicks the ball out. Minute or so wasted there. Ball out toward Woolno. And also Young comes back to Kink. Kink kicking the ball. He hasn't kicked once properly today. That was another poor kick picked up by Mount, playing in front. Out will go Byrne. And Byrne takes the mark. Takes it over Wiley. And Byrne immediately plays on. Out here to Pickin, who's led up onto the centre wing position. He'll take this very easy mark. He's on his own. But he can't move on with the ball. He's always looking to go back and take the set kick, and that's what he's done this time. And Collingwood have got to move the ball quickly. It comes back toward Olsen. Olsen can't get rid of it. Now he punches it. Tries to get it toward Moore. Moore taps it out in front of him. He's after it again. He's tapped it, but it goes back towards Strawn. Ricochets off Strawn's body over towards Craig Stewart. Went for a hand pass in there, trying to find a free kick as Olsen. He won't get it, and is picked up by Mountain. The Richmond defenders take the ball out of danger zone yet again. Kick it towards the safety of the boundary line, and it's gone out of bounds. Coming up toward the centre wing, half-forward flank hall, Richmond. And Magro laying right next to Bartlett now. Bartlett is not too worried about Magro. Up goes Peter Moore, taps it out in front, but it comes back off a Richmond hand, off Bateman toward Ray Byrne. Byrne kicks it long. Here's another chance for Malthouse. Malthouse has been grabbed, and he'll take the free kick. As Weirmouth says, well, he didn't bounce it the first time. Didn't punch it the first time. He bounced it. And there's the kick by Malthouse up toward the centre. Up there's a chance there for Woolno. He didn't take the mark. It came off his hands. Over toward Raines. Raines to Jess. Jess is kicking long. Hit the post. Hit the post. That's the fourth poster. Three to Collingwood. One to Richmond. And that, of course, is... I suppose, ironically, a lucky break for Collingwood, because there's been some easy shots missed by Richmond today. The ball kicked in, picked up and marked by Kink, and he plays on immediately.
And kicks to the outer side of the ground looking for Woolno. It's very quiet, this, and Woolno ducked into the tackle, and he's getting a free kick and a 15-metre penalty against Welsh for throwing the ball away. And that brings Woolno up onto the half-forward line, right onto the practice wicket area at the Melbourne Cricket Ground on the outer side. And Woolno is now kicked with depth up towards full forward. The defence combined to punch it away, and it goes down to Dunn. A long raking hand pass finds Wood. Wood does likewise to get it to Bourke, and Bourke kicks short to Rowlings, just a little bit short, and it's going to bounce over the line out of bounds. Morris chesting Rowlings away. It's out of bounds on centre wing position on the member's side of the ground. Perhaps a little bit towards Collingwood's attacking zone by about 8 or 10 metres. It's 77 points to 28. 3.5 minutes of time on have been played in the second quarter. Comes down to Waitman. Waitman cleverly handballs to Raines, who's killed Dacos. And Raines kicks up towards the half-forward line. And Riley stretches to take the mark. Wiley on the half-forward flank on the member side of the ground, coming in now and booting it long up towards the full-forward spot. There's a lead up by Roach. He's in front there. Down to the ground it goes. And Ireland... and took a week to get rid of it. It was held to him. So the umpire says, and he's going to bounce the ball in the forward pocket for Richmond, who were doing everything but take the flag.
I think Ireland felt he might have marked if it was off a lot of hands before him.
May have done so at the bounce, as Cloak and Moore wanted to get it down to Morris. Morris will hand pass to Byrne. Collingwood coming around the member side from their half-back line. Kick it, that is Byrne up towards centre wing. Kane had the first grab, couldn't hold it. Went down to Carlson, who's been quiet. Play on is the call. Carlson can't break clear, such is the fierceness of the tackling. At the 29 and a half minute mark, we find Richmond 11-11 leading Collingwood 3-10. That's 77-28. An umpire Della coming into bounce on the centre wing position on the member side of the ground. Moore will win the duel, but he doesn't get a decisive knockdown. It's gone into one or two players there. It flipped out, coming out towards Shaw, but Collingwood haven't got any pace. But Carlson eventually picks up and hand passes to Davis.
And Davis is trying to use a bit of pace now. He's gone for one bounce and a hand pass to Pickin. Oh, Billy Pickin, can you kick it? And he has, I think. He's put it through. Well, that was all Davis who got that one. He got it over toward Billy Pickin, and he wobbles up when he takes those kicks. But that time he went and kicked very accurately. Straight through the centre it went, and at the 30 and a half minute, almost 31 minutes gone down here in the second quarter, and Collingwood's got their fourth goal. Four goals, 10-34, to Richmond 11-11-77. They need a miracle, Collingwood. We've seen miracles before. Will we see a miracle today? Greg Browne.
The only two people who can do it, I believe, are Pickin and Ray Shaw. Pickin kicked that goal, and Shaw's the only one who can lift them. Apart from that, Moore has to get a lot more out of his play for Collingwood to get back into it.
All right, what have you got to say about it, Frank?
No, I think Collingwood are gone. They've lost that drive on their forward line. Some of the players are much too slow up there. Lowe, Stewart and Kick got to do a lot more.
Okay, well, Pickin's credit with that goal. And the score, 4-10-34, Richmond 11-11-77, 3LW Greater Melbourne Building Society scoreboard.
Collingwood are 43 points behind as the ball has bounced, and Lee won it first, then Moore, then Olsen, tapping it to the outer side of the ground to go to Dacos, Dacos to Woolnow, onto the left foot, up to the half-forward line, but standing in the way is Stephen Mount. It's in 1970 that Collingwood led by 44 points in at half-time interval. This time they're down by 43. A pretty close game, a pretty close relationship. It's gone to Ray Shaw, it's gone to the forward. Collingwood were going into attack from centre-half forward, but after a brilliant first half, at half-time, Richmond on the 3RW Greater Melbourne scoreboard are 11-11-77, and they lead.
It'll be great to have a contest because this grand final, billed as one of the greatest of all time. There's the bounce by Bill Dallas. It's not a good bounce. It favours Mark Lee, but in goes Peter Moore. Tries to punch it further on. Can't do so. Goes to Wood. Chance for Young. Young can't take it under control. He's gone in. Oh, they'll be kicking in danger there. And Young takes his free kick. He very nearly had his head kicked off, and Young kicks that ball long, right down to where Pickens trying to get in a position to get the ball. Come out to Davis. Davis loses the run of it. It's gone loose, picked up down there by Wiley. Wiley kicks the ball long. Up goes Peter Moore and Mark Lee. They punch it away from one another. Ball comes over and turned to Olsen. Olsen to Young. Young goes for a hand pass. It's pretty indiscriminate. There's nobody about. Peter Moore tries to get the run of the ball. Can't. The players are in hard now, and it's a free kick against Morris. Morris is up on that half-forward line. And some Richmond bodies have got to pick themselves up. Wiley's one of the ones on the ground. And one who does pick himself up will be Mount. Mount gets the free kick and kicks it out to where Woolnow was in front. Woolnow takes the ball away from Rowlings. It's going back toward Malthouse. He can't take the mark. Burke has forced the ball close to the boundary line. Picked up by Davis. Davis bumped hard after he kicked the ball. He's got it down long. And Richmond come away again. This time it's Strawn. Strawn down long. Up goes Magro. He's in front. And of Bartlett, immediately gets his kick in, but it's all Richmond. Coming out again is Kane. Kane kicks it with a banana kick. Good kick it was too. Down to Wiley. He taps it on. They don't bother to try and take it under control. This is good play here, as I think that'll be Craig Stewart playing on the back line. He's kicked it long. The fortune favours the brave. Out in front and playing it hard was Francis Burke. Took the ball under control. Kicked it long, trying to find Waitman. Waitman keeps it in play. Oh, well done down there in Ray Byrne. Kept his eye on the ball. Tapped it away nicely. Trapped it and then hand passed it over to Woolnow. Woolnow for Collingwood up to where Kink's outnumbered. It's tapped down from that player and goes straight to Francis Burke. Burke with a left foot kick has found Raines. Raines the racehorse, puts it out wide. He's trying to pick up Wood. Woods about to pounce on the ball. Carlson's following up. In goes Raines again. Raines is too strong, and he gets a kick in as Macro tackles him strongly. Up it goes toward full forward, trying to take the mark was Roach. Couldn't take it. It goes to Macro, and Collingwood are out on their own. If they can capitalise to Carlson.
And Carlson from the half-back flank has steered the ball in towards the centre of the ground. Kinkers in front. They're obviously trying hard to get in front. A hand pass comes out, and Richmond go away. And this time it'll be kicked across towards the member side of the ground. Coming out there is Woolnough, and Woolnough takes the mark. Richmond lagging a little bit now, but the hand pass has gone across the wheel now. Bounced awkwardly. Richmond haven't found their feet yet. Now they have, with Wells picking up, getting on the left foot, looking for Cloak. And Cloak's in front of his opponent. Cloak was in front of Stewart. And it's got to be a good player to suppress this big fellow once he gets that huge bulk of his in front. Cloak is lining them up from position directly in front of goal, kicking towards the big scoreboard end at the Melbourne Cricket Ground, and that's a bad kick. Well, it's a good kick. It fell off his boot in a peculiar fashion, but it went through for a goal, and you can't do much more than that. It's that awkward kicking style, and Richmond have tasted first blood. Cloak has kicked two goals, and Richmond have kicked 12-11, 12-11-83, and that's a great advantage over Collingwood's 4-10-34, 3 minutes or 3.5 minutes into the third quarter of the 1980 Grand Final. Umpire Robinson looking around to see that his boundary umpires are in position and sees that they are, has a look towards umpire Della standing opposite him, and now comes in to put the ball down and does it well. It's a huge bounce, and going up as Lee to do it again. Got it down to Shaw, though. Shaw intercepting, kicked up towards centre-half forward. Kink was in front of Smith then. Kink saw the ball slide down his chest. Now he's trying to break clear. Had the fumbles. He's besieged by Richmond players who tap it away. It's gone in towards the centre of the ground. Young comes in for Collingwood to hand pass up towards centre-half forward, but Malthouse is caught. Holding the ball. It was a good tackle there by the Collingwood player in Morris. And Morris will get the free kick at about centre-half forward, perhaps a little bit further towards the centre than that position. From there, he chooses to kick in towards centre-half forward. It's gone off the hands of the pack to Pickin. Pickin weaving and wobbling around. Hand passes haphazardly. Carlson picks it up. Coming in as Bourke. Dropped the mark. Hand pass out by Tony Shaw, who's on the ground. And it was knocked through by Rowlings for 1 point. So Tony Shaw spotted, popped up there in the forward pocket for Collingwood, who kicked the point to go on a 4-11-35, Collingwood, Richmond 12-11-83.
And a big kick out there by Strawn, where Carlson finds himself outreached by the big fella in Dunn, and the ball comes to the ground, and Richmond away again. This time it was Greg Smith, and Smith down toward Bartlett. Bartlett gets the mark in front of Macro, immediately plays on, trying to find Roach. Roach right up the corner. Deep in that forward pocket, has taken the mark. McCormick has got him covered, and Roach has to go back on an angle, and there's no one there, no Collingwood player up there to try and stop Roach from running around. This was what happened to William out in the first quarter, but Roach is coming in a direct line, is not going to run around. Reckons he can kick it from that angle. The goal umpire says he missed, and that was rather strange that he didn't try to manoeuvre himself around. No Collingwood defender near him to back him up. The reason for that is they're playing man-to-man, and Moore is not going down into that back line to make the extra man. Anyhow, it was a point only, and we see now McCormick for Collingwood kick the ball back in, trying to find Moore over his head, and in goes Raines with plenty of pace. He's got plenty of run left in him, trying to get rid of it, and got rid of it nicely. Out toward Rowlings. Rowlings with a left foot kick. Olsen trying to lift his legs, and he's finding it difficult. In goes Carlson, throws himself at the ball with his fist and punches it out of bounds, at least saves the day. So now, might have been Ray Shaw that did that, and Ray Shaw pushed it across the line, the ball about to be thrown in. Out there in the centre wing position, up goes Peter Moore. Peter Moore taps it down. There's plenty of Richmond players again in the band. They've hand-passed the ball out clearly. Here's an opportunity for Wiley. Wiley with a left foot kick. I think he might have gone. Oh-ho! He put it on the left boot, and he's put it through for a big goal. And Richmond go to 13. 13 goals, 12, the total of 90. Now they've got the big taste of blood. First two goals, and Collingwood at 4-11, 35, into that five-minute mark of the third quarter. The second goal to Robert Wiley for the Tigers, and certainly reigning goals at this stage. Umpire Della with the ball.
Moving it towards the centre. 55 points the difference. It's a huge margin at the moment. and there's Lee to win it out of the centre, and Shaw roving to it again, got clear but lost the run of it, picked up by Morris. Morris kicks to centre half forward, Picken overrunning, the ball is recovered first, hotly pursued by Strawn. Picken has ducked and gone to the ground, the ball comes out of the pack, Strawn goes in, knocks it to the ground in turn, and the umpire is going to go in and bounce. He'll bounce in the right forward pocket for Collingwood up at the punt road end of the ground in front of the huge crowd. Puts it down now, and the rucks converge, knocked away, down towards Waitman, struggling to get out of the pack, and he did so. He got a hand pass out to Malthouse, and Malthouse gave it back to him, and then Waitman hand passed up to Kane, coming around the outer side of the ground. Mervyn Kane has kicked towards Wiley, and Wiley Mark cleverly outmanoeuvring Rayburn, who's been quiet today.
Fight behind play up in that forward
and
pocket.
Wiley plays on now, kicking up towards full forward towards Cloak. Cloak running into an open goal, and he puts it through. Another goal to Richmond, who are romping away, walking away, waltzing away, do what you like. Three goals to Cloak, and it's Richmond 14 goals, 12.96. They are 10 goals, one ahead of Collingwood, who are 4.11.35.
All right, well, a call by Tony Shaw, telling Ray Shaw to either get out of there and let give me a chance to row, but Ray Shaw stays in the centre of the square. We try and get some comments here. Let's move to you, Rex Hunt.
Well, Collingwood just haven't any answer to Richmond's power game, as we've called it since halftime. They're knocking the ball on. They've got these tremendous two focal points in attack. And I will say right now that Collingwood are gone.
Right, Neil Kerley.
I'd have to support that. They just haven't got any winners, Collingwood, where Richmond got winners all over the ground. They're playing very aggressive, very disciplined, and real professional football.
Umpire Robinson moving in at the 7-8 minute mark now of this quarter. The ball's taking a long time to come back, but he's moving in to bounce the ball. It's a lovely bounce. Up will go Peter Moore with the run, but still Mark Lee is able to take it out. Gets it out toward Welsh. Welsh of Richmond down toward the half forward line. Here's a chance for Burns. Still puts it the wrong way. He puts it out wide over toward Cloak. Cloak come back on the right boot. Is he going to snap this one? No. As McCormick will take the ball away for Collingwood. But it's all Richmond still out there on that outer half-back flank. And Wood goes very close to the boundary line, keeps the ball in play. Hand passes it, they're playing in pairs, over to Wiley. Wiley in turn, gives it back to Wood. Wood kicks it strong, up goes toward Roach, it's down the ground. Going in there is Craig Stewart. Hand pass out to McCormick, and this is long last, the Collingwood mark. It falls at the hands of Byrne. Byrne with a hand pass over to Morris. Morris kicking the ball up long. Up goes Mount, right over the top of Picken. Picken stays down on the field. Picked up by Tony Shaw. He's trying to get it to Craig Davis. Davis back to Tony Shaw. He's going to run into a heap of trouble here. He gets it for being too high a tackle by Emmett Dunn, who absolutely towers over him. And so Shaw, that is Tony Shaw, will go back and have a shot. I wonder whether he can kick this distance. It's about 60 metres out from goal. Take a long kick, this one. Warming up down in front of us. Slide Ricky. The ball falls short. A chance for Collingwood to force it toward the boundary line. They do, but it goes out of bounds. And Ricky Barham has probably had needles or whatever. And he's trying to warm that leg up. The ball being thrown in now. Up they go. It was Picken trying to tap it down. There's a bad tackle. It'll be a tackle which will be free kick. And Richmond will take this one. Could be Malthouse down there. Wait and see who picks himself up. He's prostrate on the ground, but now starting to pick himself up. And I don't think it is Malthouse. It is. And whoever that is, yes, it is Mickey, and he does look a bit groggy as he takes this free kick, kicks down long, and oh, there was beautiful football by Richmond. They had two players in between, sandwiched between Moore, and it was Emmett Dunn to take the mark. He kicked the ball out wide toward the half forward line. In will go Welsh. Pretty clever player in this side, Welsh. Taps it back to Bartlett. And there you see Bartlett taking that mark one-handed. Running backwards, taps it with the right hand, back into the body, clinches it. And with Young standing the mark, Bartlett going back to have a shot at goal. Now Bartlett's already kicked four goals. And this could be his fifth coming up. Richmond are 14-12-96 on 3AW Carlton United scoreboard. Collingwood 4-11-35 as Kevin Bartlett, the veteran player on the ground, kicks toward goal, misses this one. And it's 1 point only. Richmond 14-13-97 now. And Collingwood are 4-11-35 as Collingwood pounce on the ball, the fullback, and is about to kick it in.
Well, it'll be Stewart to kick the ball back into play, and He does so now, kicking in from the railway or scoreboard end, driving the ball straight down the centre of the ground, and Moore for once is high over the top of Lee and takes the mark. He hand passes straight to Wood, would you believe? Wood's grab, play on is the call. Byrne taking the ball away from the tackle, kicking up towards centre-half forward. Picken was high there. Richmond defence through Mount, knock it away out towards Waitman. Waitman had it was taken away from him in the centre, and Richmond can't get it out of there. Kane eventually lost the ball to Olsen, and Olsen kicks through centre-half forward to Davis. Davis was set back waiting for the mark, and Francis Burke came away and knocked it away with magnificent defence. The ball was only about a foot away from the chest of Davis when Burke knocked it away. It's a point to Collingwood, and it's applause like you get a cricket match. It's not the roar of a crowd. Over towards the centre wing position, and Dunn takes the mark between centre wing and half back flank for Richmond on the outer side of the ground. Hand passes quickly onto Rowlings, who speeds away, has two bounces, getting towards half back flank. Hand passes to Raines. Raines will head towards the centre with that flowing style of his, onto the left foot to kick to the half forward line, and Wiley outmanoeuvres Byrne yet again and takes the mark. Richmond are killing Collingwood in every department of the game, and it's a bit sad to see in a grand final. And now Wiley has kicked it to Cloak leading upfield. Stewart bears down on it. A great tackle by Bartlett, holding the ball against Stewart, and the free kick will go to the little bloke, surely. No play on is the call. Well, it's gone to centre wing position. Dunn takes it under control. Hand passes to Kane. Kane likewise to Raines. Raines breaks the tackle, kicks up towards centre-half forward, but dropping in at that position at centre-half back is Ray Shaw, the Collingwood captain.
And Ray Shaw takes it round the member stand side. Here's Kink. Kink takes the mark. He's got to get around the tackle yet. He's done that. He hand passes over to Woolnow. Woolnow's at centre-half forward. He kicks that ball long down to the punt road end. He's trying to find a player down there, and throwing himself out is Picken, and Picken's got an easy free. Billy Della gave that one, and Picken, the master at being able to position himself and throw himself around, has got a pretty easy free kick, and he's got a chance to goal. He's only 20 metres out, directly in front, at the 14-minute mark, and through it goes for a Collingwood goal, and that makes Collingwood now 5 goals. On the 3AW Carlton United scoreboard, 5 goals, 12, a total of 42, Richmond 14, 13, 97, and it's early days yet in this third quarter, and Richmond really looking a powerful combination. Like to pick up a few players here, Neil Kerley, from this Richmond side.
Yes, that can make our side home, but full marks to Tony Jewell. He's got these players playing a very disciplined brand of football. Teamwork is the emphasis, and they're looking very good.
Okay, the ball's back in the centre with umpire Robinson as he comes in, bounce the ball, perfect bounce, best man win. And I think Moore got that side tap out, but Dunn ticks it on the volley, kicks it right down where up goes Craig Stewart for Collingwood at the centre-half back position and takes the mark. He's going to hand pass the ball over to Magro. Magro's coming up toward the centre. Will kick long to position to Moore. Moore has Lee bearing down on him. Good effort, Lee. Didn't interfere at all. Tapped the ball away from Moore. Great football. Picked up by Welsh. Welsh in turn for Richmond. Down to where they take a very clever mark by Kane. Oh, well done, Tony Shaw. He was going the same way as the ball. Managed to keep it in play. Then hand pass it back to Young. Young evades the tackle there. It was a bad decision there by Bill Della because he stopped the play. Incidentally, it didn't hit Young's face. It hit the ball, but Collingwood are moving the ball better now. They got it to Carlson. He's going to be pounced upon. He eludes two tackles. Well done, young Carlson. Two bounces. Going up to have a shot. That's third bounce. He'll kick it goal now. Can he put it through? No, it's disappointing. It's through for 1 point only after three bounces. But Collingwood trying to lift their play, desperately trying to lift their play at the 15-minute mark into the third quarter, with only one goal kick so far for them by Picken, and Richmond have already had three. Folks kick two and Wiley one in this quarter.
Burke chooses the outer side of the ground to kick two over there on the outer side, and the mark is taken by Wood, who's won handsomely all day on his wing. There's no doubt about that. He's up towards the half-back flank position as he takes his kick and moving in to do so now, travelling, taking the ball around through the centre wing position up towards the half-forward line. Cloak bat manoeuvres Stewart. Cloak takes the mark, wobbles away, has two bounces. He's got to kick quickly, and he does. It might be the best thing he did because he's kicked a goal. He didn't have time to worry about it. He just had a quick look up. That's four he's kicked. And the Richmond power game is shown on the scoreboard with 15-13, 103, and Collingwood 5-13, 43. That's the score.
on the Freo W Carlton United scoreboard, and we've played 16 and a half minutes into the third term of this grand final.
Well, there's plenty of run in them. What would you do, Gary?
I wouldn't know what to do at this stage, Harry. I really wouldn't. If I was in Tommy Hafey's shoes, there's not really many moves that he can make at all. He's just getting beaten everywhere.
Okay, Ricky Barham. Is he back on? Back on the field. Up will go Peter Moore. He tapped it away all right. Came towards Wearmouth. Wearmouth doesn't seem to know where the ball is today. And this will be a free kick to Collingwood. As we find Woolnow underneath the 15-metre... No, it's not on Welsh. But it looked as though it was going to be 15-metre on Welsh then. Sticking to Woolnow like a tiger. Up they come. Nobody can take the mark a chance for Shaw. That is Tony Shaw. He hand passed the ball out. It went too hard, too fast. It came out toward Greg Smith of Richmond. He intercepted nicely, got it toward Welsh. Welsh tried to go one way, back the other, and Woolnow, anticipating well, punched the ball out of his hands and punched it straight out of bounds. So the ball to be thrown into the centre wing right at the interchange gate. 18 minutes gone. Richmond 15-13-103, Collingwood 5-13-43.
Nothing happened out of that throw-in. Neither ruckman able to get the tap down, and the umpire Robinson's decided to bounce the ball on the centre wing position about 9 metres, 8 metres in from the boundary line in front of the members' stand. 15-13-5-13, as umpire Robinson moves in to bounce the ball, all the pep and fire seems to have gone out of the game. As far as the crowd's concerned, they're strangely quiet. Lee won it again, got it out of the pack. Byrne, too long with the ball. A great tackle by Little Waitman, and Ray Byrne, not having the best of days, one of Collingwood's good players during the final series, but certainly not today. It was a great tackle by Waitman, and his pass to Wiley on the half-forward flank is as equally as good. Wiley's kick now up towards the goal front. The big men of Richmond are there, and the big arms go up. It's knocked away. Bartlett picks it up, kicks it over his head, and I think he kicked it out of bounds. Well, Bartlett has had enough shots. You wouldn't put that one down as one of them to equal the record of 7 goals in a grand final. He's kicked 4, and the game's not over by a long way yet. He may yet do it. He'll have plenty of chances, I think. It's Magro in the left-back pocket in front of the big scoreboard, defending at that end of the ground and kicking it around the members' flank. Lee in front, Jess from behind, thumps it out over to Kane. Kane hand passes to Bartlett, who weaves past all sorts of tackles, but he's tackled strongly by Tony Shaw and kicked it over the line on the full. So the free kick is going to Olsen. Several Collingwood supporters cheer Bartlett's misfortune then, and the free kick goes to Olsen in the back pocket on the member side of the ground and defending at the scoreboard end. He naturally takes it around the member's wing, and coming behind is Lee to thump it away out in the direction of Kane. Kane hand passes to Rowlings. Rowlings has got to break 2 tackles. He hand passes to Bartlett. Bartlett snaps for goal. This too is offline and might be a point. At the best it is, and that's another behind to Richmond, and Collingwood have stopped. Richmond are 15-14-104, Collingwood 5-13-43, and we've played 20 minutes into the quarter.
Without wanting to be rude, I wonder whether they're really able to get started today. Well, there's the kick in by Collingwood's fullback, and Woolnow is definitely trying his heart out. He's kicked the ball off the bounce on the volley. He kicked it down trying to find Dacos, and Dacos sees the ball running over the line before he can reach it. Well, certainly it's been a bit of a disappointment. This is a no contest, but the crowd should remember they've really seen powerhouse football by the Tigers. Here's Big Lee going up in front of Morris. Peter Moore not there as the ball comes off Mark Lee over to Greg Smith. Smith in turn down to Wiley, and Wiley's marked again. So Wiley of Richmond, too strong, too big for Ronnie Wearmouth, and Ronnie looking very tired. As the ball kicked down toward the forward pocket area. Up they go. Nobody can take the mark. Comes down toward Rowlings. Rowlings has a short kick out toward Roach. Roach in turn to the boundary line, and the ball is out of bounds yet again. Matt Groh trying to con the boundary umpire there.
Worth a try.
He was trying to say to Lee Patterson, I reckon that's out on the full, but it did bounce at least... half a metre in front of the line. Up goes Cloak, gets a tap out for Richmond, but straight to Magro, and Magro there up to the centre of the ground, but it's all Richmond. They tap it down into Raines. Raines kicks long, beautiful kick, point, and at the 21 minute mark, Richmond 15-15-105, Collingwood 5-13-43, 3AW Carlton United scoreboard, and McCormick to kick the ball back into play. Well, there's the kick by McCormick, out to that outer side. Up goes Kink to try and take the ball under control. Didn't do so. Went to Ronnie Wearmouth. Wearmouth in turn towards Shaw. They punched the ball away, but the fearless tackle, kick off the ground by Shaw, loves it up into the defensive zone for Richmond. Richmond's come through strongly. A free kick has been paid to Collingwood.
And Collingwood will take it with Ronnie Wearmouth picking himself up off the ground. Hasn't featured much in the play today. He's on the outer, almost centre wing position. Long way from goal. Goes for a short pass, trying to pick up a Collingwood lead up. But both Richmond players there were in front of the Collingwood player. And so Francis Burke. So Francis takes it away for the Tigers. And with a left foot kick down there toward the centre line, at going up as Rayburn to take the mark for Collingwood.
I think Collingwood have got Ricky Barron playing at full forward. In fact, I'm sure that he is up there. Anyhow, it's kicked across towards the centre of the ground. And Carlson takes the mark. There's Barron leading up there. And it's Burke on him. So Barron was playing at full forward for Collingwood. Carlson now coming in from the centre half forward spot to kick through that position up towards the goal square. Several players massed there. The Richmond defence knock it away over towards the line in the back pocket on the outer side at the punt road end, and it's drifted over the line out of bounds. Richmond 15-15-105, Collingwood 5-13-43. And Barham, you may recall, Harry kicked six goals playing at full forward for the reserves down at Geelong, so he's not out of position there in a sense, although it's a desperate play by Collingwood. Out of the pack and it through for another point to Collingwood, and they go on to 5-14-44. That point was kicked by Dacos, and Richmond are on 15-15-105.
Okay, we've got to about 23 minutes gone, and not much that anyone can say about the game. It's very, very one-sided, and Richmond are answering every approach by Collingwood. Collingwood desperately trying to give their fans a lift, but it's not going that way. Francis Burke kicks in. Up in front was Collingwood player. Markley comes over the top, was touched. And correctly, umpire Bill Dallow calls play on. Markley, therefore, kicks the ball wide. Woolnough will be first there. Woolnough gets it well under control, kicks it back. Umpire Robinson coming over to speak to Young for that unnecessary tackle. As the ball comes down, picked up by King. Rene King looking for Barham. Barham sets himself. I think he might have it. Barham's got it, I think. Barham had the mark. And Francis Burke says no. Barham, as I called, I thought he had his hands on the ball first there, and he's been paid the mark. Francis Burke not happy, but Barham going back gingerly, right in front of goal, has hit the post. Well, it's not, it is not Collingwood's day, no matter what, because that's the fourth poster for Collingwood, and that's very disappointing for them. Four posters, and of course Richmond have had one. And that point makes Collingwood 5-15-45. They're exactly 10 goals behind Richmond, 15-15-105.
Burke kicks to the outer side of the ground. It was Ireland up high, but it went down to Olsen. Olsen kicks and brings it around towards centre-half back. Malthouse has plenty of time to get rid of the ball. Hand passing out to Kane. Kane to Waitman, and Waitman coming upfield. Runs through centre-half back. A long hand pass to Lee, waiting in the centre of the ground. He'll break away for more, but Lee's hand pass was bad. And Tony Shaw's able to knock it over towards Wearmouth. And Wearmouth was a bit stiff. He's caught holding the ball by Waitman. Waitman hand passes to Wood. Richmond playing on brilliantly through Wood, up towards the full forward spot, and Magro sits back and takes the mark. Magro between centre-half back and full-back, kicks to the member side of the ground, coming over as Lee, and Woolnough takes a good mark as Big Lee rushes at him, and so too did Peter Walsh, and Woolnough took the strong mark. 15-metre penalty against Walsh, and Woolnough will go up to centre wing position on the grandstand on the member side of the ground. From there he kicks it up towards centre half forward. The Tiger defence are high, knocked down by Strawn. Kane knocked it away when he could have grabbed it, but nobody probably called him. Waitman, having a good third quarter, has broken clear with the ball and delivered a beautiful pass to Bartlett, who had to just lean forward a little to take the mark in the pit of the stomach as he went down to his knees. Magro standing the mark. Bartlett on the half forward flank on the member side of the ground, kicking up to a full forward spot. Cloak and Jess, they're all up there, knocked to the ground. Rowlings comes in and a quick snap goes offline for 1 point. Richmond 15-16-106, Collingwood 5-15-45. Interesting, you know, during the season the Tigers would not be drawn into comparing this team with their big teams of the past, of the 70s, but I think after this match you'll find that people will say they're just as good. It's a great team and they're playing great football. McCormick coming up towards the line at the 25 minute mark in the third quarter.
Ball's been kicked in. Collingwood's Rene King trying to outmark his own teammate and Stewart. And that's the way Collingwood have been playing today. Woolnough drops back, tries to take the mark. In comes Strawn, hits it to the ground. Tony Shaw picks it up. He's done something since he's been on. Tries to get it up where Mount also attempts to knock it away. Goes to Morris. Morris has put the ball under one arm. Is going to try and kick a left foot. Goal is going to go close. Well shepherded. Wrong side of the post. Well shepherded by Barham. Put Francis Burke just a little on offline, and it went through for behind. Collingwood's ball now is their best kick getter. He's got 14. Ray Shaw 13 as Francis Burke kicks the ball in. Doesn't waste time trying to find Emmett Dunn. Punched away from that player is a chance for Ray Shaw. Couldn't take it under control. Tried to tap it one way. Wood was in the way. Wood took it. Passed beautifully with a foot. Straight toward Lee. Lee gives it over to his teammate and Raines goes once and twice and two bounces and then kicks long for another behind. If they're kicking goals, it would be more than an embarrassment at the 27-minute mark into the time on period down here by 2 minutes at the MCG for the 1980 Grand Final. And Richmond are 15-17, 107 to Collingwood 5-16, 46.
McCormick again kicking in up towards the centre-half back position and King comes in to take a mark amidst ironical cheers from the Collingwood supporters, probably Richmond also. King at centre-half back drives it through the centre of the ground up towards centre-half forward, knocked away by Mount, down to Emmett Dunn, Dunn into the centre to Kane. Kane hand passes to Waitman, handling it again but a bit late this time. And Raines hand passes intercepted by Ireland. Ireland from the centre of the ground is kicked up to centre-half forward. Burke in front of Barham was nudged out, pushed out, and the umpire, Della, was right on the spot to see that infringement. So free kick to Francis Burke. It may make him feel a little bit happier about that mark, but I still think Barham had it. Anyhow, Burke has kicked from the centre-half back spot over to the centre-wing position, coming around the member side of the ground, and there's another free kick, and this time it'll go to Collingwood. 27 minutes into the third quarter. Collingwood 5-16, trail Richmond 15-17 on the 3RW Carlton United scoreboard, and it's Peter Moore, the 79 Brownlow medalist, kicking up towards the half-forward line, and Pickin comes in from the back to take a mark.
Now, Billy Pickin has already kicked two goals and has moved down to centre-half forward. He's a long way from goal, and I don't think Billy in his wildest dreams could kick this distance, but he's going back. And, yes, a 15-metre penalty against Wells for running up beside Pickin. Umpire Robinson right on that one. Not allowed within 10 metres, of course. We all know that. And Pickin now's got a chance of kicking the goal. He puts it on its way. It's the wrong side of the post. And it's through for a behind.
I must explain a nice little byplay here between the umpire and the coach. Neil Kerley disagreeing with Harry's ruling at the 10 metres and them both shaking their heads in anguish, as it were.
But, of course, as Knuckles knows, it was correct. And at least he's putting a little bit of lightness into the game, because it's a very dreary game from Collingwood's viewpoint. Great from Richmond. Ball being kicked in, going back from Big Stewart, right over toward Pickin again. And he's taken the mark this time on the boundary line on the half-forward flank on the outer side of the ground. They're kicking down to the punt road, Ed. And Pickin, with that wobbly style of his, up to where King's trying to mark from behind, won't get in front. Ball comes off hands. Kicked away again by Raines, down toward the centre wing. In goes Welsh. Played a pretty good game, Welsh, you know, when you all can come to consider. Tries to get it to Rowlings. Rowlings, his former teammate. Rowlings taps it back into the play, close to the boundary line. Hand passed over to Lee. Lee still quick enough to get the kick, and Young of Collingwood gets in front of Jess on this occasion and takes the mark. Now, Young sees the lead up there to Tony Shaw. Tony Shaw takes the mark as the big arm of Mervyn Keane came across to try and punch the ball away.
Tony Shaw breaks away and kicks to Ray Shaw, his brother, on the centre wing position. Ray Shaw wobbles away in that familiar style of his. Gets up to the half forward line and kicks up towards full forward. Burke in front, I thought, had the mark, but it went down to Mount, and Mount calmly hand passed it through the goals, as it were, or punched it through as a better interpretation of his act. And it's a point to Collingwood, who've gone on to 5-18, 48. They trail Richmond 15-17, 107 on the 3RW Carlton and United scoreboard. Well, that was the score at three-quarter time, but I'll repeat it. At three-quarter time in the 1980 Grand Final, Richmond 15-17, 107.
For the start of the last quarter. And looking desperate now, Collingwood, but Peter Moore determined to try and lift. Up he goes, and he got that tap out. He got it out to Dacos. Dacos immediately pounced upon. That's the point about Richmond, is their very quick tackling. And they don't give Collingwood a chance to get settled. The ball's out wide, near the boundary line. In goes Welsh again, and pass it back to Malthouse. Malthouse gets the kick in, prior to being tackled by Wearmouth. It comes up toward Jess. Jess can't take the mark. Ball comes out the back. Here's a chance now for Young, for Collingwood. He taps it across, looking for Morris. Morris puts it back. Young ducks the head, can't get rid of the ball. Play on goal, the umpire's a bit ball up. Umpire Della moving in the ball up. Richmond on the 3W Carlton United scoreboard, well and truly in control on 15-17, 107 and Collingwood 5-18, a total of 48. Umpire Della puts the ball down. Peter Moore will tap it out. Taps it back, trying to find Morris. The ball's come over, though, to Dacos. Dacos, in turn, gave it to Byrne. Byrne kicked the ball long, right down toward the centre half-forward position. Nobody's home. In will go Wood, taps it out the back, and that's a tactic, an interesting one, by Richmond all day today. They tap it out towards Smith, and Smith kicks high, trying to find Bartlett up in front. Didn't take the mark. Kept the ball down in their area, however. Here's a chance now for McCormick. He got rid of it. Oh, back to Jess. Jess into an open goal and kicks it, the easiest one. And wasn't that great play? And Cloak's after Jess to congratulate him and all the other players, and Waitman, who gave it out to Jess with that slick hand pass. And Jess just loped away from the opposition there to get the ball through for an easy goal. And Richmond get the first goal again in this quarter. They've virtually got the first goal in every quarter. After 1 minute of play, Richmond go to 16-17, 113, to Collingwood, 5 goals, 18-48. The ball back there with umpire Robinson about to bounce it again. Just looking to see whether they did. Yes, they got the first goal in every quarter so far.
Well, Collingwood,
they can't have any more.
Collingwood for certain are going to get the brand Collie Wobbles back again. There's nothing sure. The critics will give it to them. It's gone to the outer side of the ground with Dacos in hot pursuit. He gets it under control and kicks with the left foot up towards the half-forward flank on the outer side, travelling to the scoreboard end, but it's out of bounds, and the throw-in will take place on the half-forward flank for Collingwood as they travel down in the last quarter, up to the, or down or up, whichever way you like, to the railway or scoreboard end. That scoreboard, the 3OW Carlton United scoreboard, shows Richmond 16-17 to 5-18. The ball comes out of the pack to Wearmouth. Wearmouth to Woolnow. Woolnow, his 15th kick, is kicked up towards full forward. But Strawn is more than happy to rise on the back of his teammate Emmett Dunn and pop it through for a point to take Collingwood on to 5-19. And four of those have hit the post, and three or four of them that I can recall distinctly having been punched through, three by the opposition. Wood takes the mark from the kick-in, hand passes to Kane. Kane will hand pass to Wiley. Wiley, showing plenty of pace, has a bounce, waits for it to bounce well for him. It does, and he kicks it up to Cloak in the forward pocket, and Cloak marks. Richmond moved that ball down the ground at an incredible speed then, and Cloak, in the forward pocket on the member side of the ground, kicking to the punt road end, has a chance to kick another goal. At the 3.5 minute mark, it's 16-17 to 5-19. An easy victory to Richmond coming up. And Cloak, lining them up now, has put it on its way, but it's offline. We'll be lucky if it makes a point. In fact, it just did. It got in about a metre away from the behind post or less. And Richmond move on to 16-18, 114, Collingwood 5-19, 49.
I think you'll find Peter Moore's gone to centre-half forward, and Craig Stewart's been put in the ruck. The ball being kicked in and marked again by a Tiger. This time it's Peter Welsh. Welsh for Richmond, taking the mark, and he'll kick it long. It's a long torpedo punt. What a kick that is. That's a point, but by word it went a long way. And the breeze, what there is of it, favouring the punt road end. Another behind to the Tigers after 4 minutes of play, almost coming up to 5 minutes, and they're 16-19, 115 to the total of 5-19-49. Jess almost took the mark, picked up by Tony Shaw. Maybe a Woolnow mark this one. Yes, he was in front of Welsh, and they've had a great battle, those two. There's nothing about that, and Woolnow deserves full marks for his effort, because he's been one of the two Collingwood players that really has put himself in. The ball down toward Wood, taps it out the back again. That's been done all day today, tapping out the back. However, it's picked up by Rene Kink. Kink in turn, right up. That's almost in the back there against Olsen. Comes to Peter Moore. Moore, the left foot, snap at goal. Tie, out of bounds on the pull. Well, nothing's going right for Collingwood. They're tied. They've had four hard finals games. And now they find the ball being kicked out of bounds on the pull. And therefore a free kick will go to Emmett Dunn for Richmond. Scores, repeating them, 3OW Carlton United scoreboard. And Richmond are 16-19, 115, and Collingwood 5-19, 49, 11 goals of difference.
And it's just on 6 minutes into the last quarter, with Dunn kicking it around the outer side of the ground. Warren's had a grab there, but Lee showing that abundance of pace that he's got for a big man. Tapped it across to Welsh. Welsh to Raines, who leans forward, and that beautiful style of his, takes it under control. Two bounces, a hand pass to Jess.
just into Bartlett, a bit too far for Bartlett. McCormick comes up to take the mark, drops the kick short. It was a bad one, but they'll get out of trouble through Magro hand passings to Stewart. Stewart to Young, and Young on the half-back flank, kicking it up beyond centre wing where Malthouse, who's put in pretty well, takes yet another mark in defence for Richmond. He breaks clear and a long hand pass across to Francis Burke, enjoying this bout considerably, up towards centre half forward. Was a chance for Richmond. It's taken out of the pack by Waitman as he got it from Wiley, and Waitman heads towards home, and yet another shot for Richmond has gone offline. And I think, as Harry said, just not long before three-quarter time, had they kicked straight, there'd be nothing would have stopped them from half-time or before half-time. It's now 16-20, and the crowd haven't had much to enthuse about in the entire course of the game. It's McCormick kicking it back into play, favouring the outer side, but a huge bounce gets the ball, a punch out to Bartlett, running into an open goal, hand passes quite unselfishly to Rowlings, who kicks a goal, and those who have called Bartlett hungry should witness that event. He could have kicked it probably, Bourke, but he hand passed to Rowling, and Rowlings kicks a goal, and Richmond go on to 17-20, and Collingwood remain on 5-19.
Well, there's no doubt that Bartlett, since he's been moved to the half-forward flank, he's the complete team player. You'd have to agree on that, Rex.
He's got to go down with Francis Burke, and I'll say this now as being two of the all-time greats of the VFL scene. They are just evergreens. And Bartlett has to be admired, because how many goals is that now he's kicked in the three finals games?
Well, he didn't kick that one, but he's, you can put it down as his, I suppose. There's the ball bounced in the centre by umpire Della. Up will go, it was Mark Lee again. I was going to say Stewart almost got to it. It got to Raines. Raines in turn to Kane. Kane up long. Up goes Cloak. Can't take the ball this time. Comes to ground, picked up by Magro. Magro to Young. It was good football. He got the ball, took the mark, hand passed it back to Magro. Here's a bit of a football system by Collingwood. It's down to Woolnow, but you can't get around that fellow. Well, he's a very interesting player as he covers you at the mark. He sends the ball high, does Woolnow, but it goes straight out to Malthouse. Malthouse hand passes to Strawn. Strawn up to the centre, straight to Wiley. Wiley to Bartlett, and Bartlett marks. Bartlett again. He's very popular. He's telling Roach to lead up so he can kick it over his head, which he does. And up goes Cloak, and Cloak takes yet another mark. Well, Cloak ought a goal from here. I think he can. We'll wait and see whether he'll put it through. Cloak's on a bit of an angle, though. He's missed the ones from in front, so he's probably got a better chance when there's a bit of an angle. And he put it straight through the centre. 8 minutes, 9 minutes gone, and Richmond are 18-20, 128 to Collingwood, 5-19-49. And my word, this is a real romp home for the Tigers side. But not only that, and I suppose the only people listening now would be Richmond supporters, I guess. But the way they've done it, everything they've done has got that touch of class about it. And they're being able to powerhouse that football, whether it's in the centre, no matter where it is, it keeps ricocheting up toward their players. Now, umpire Robinson coming to the bounce with Mark Lee up against Craig Stewart as Peter Moore has been sent to the forward line. Now, Stewart, but he can't beat Mark Lee. He's been on that ball all day. Taps it down to Mervyn Keane, who can kick a ball out of sight. It's come down to where it's kicked off the ground very nicely down there by Andy Ireland. Back toward Richmond it goes. Chipping in nicely was Carlson. Carlson over to Craig Stewart. Craig Stewart takes the mark, then falls over. Hand pass the ball over toward Tony Shaw. Tony Shaw's trying to find a teammate. Pickin knocked it away from the opposition. Goes to Malthouse. Plant all the umpire. Chancellor William out. He'll hand pass to Peter Moore. There's a goal. And there's six goals. Six goals on the board now for Collingwood. Six goals, 19. A total of 55 to Richmond, 18-20, 128. And I think the Collingwood crowd loved that because, well, a couple of goals now would really at least give them a little bit of compensation for what has been a most disappointing day. Waiting for the ball to go back into the centre, and there's plenty of public address announcements. Another ball probably lost. Somebody in the crowd has decided to souvenir it. And Gary Bryce and Greg Brown. Greg, we haven't heard much from you. I don't think there's much to say.
Well, from a Collingwood point of view, very little in the 113,461 people. They've gone just so quiet after the ecstatic start to this match.
Well, I suppose when you reflect on it, Greg, maybe the start of the game was where all the excitement was.
it really was in the way the match has turned out. After the first quarter, it's been all Richmond.
Stewart won it out of the centre. He gave it across to Kink. Kink's taking time to get rid of it, as he has all day. His hand pass is intercepted by Raines, who flicks it back over his head. Taken under control by Kink. He lost the run of it, and the tackle was too high. And Welch is not satisfied about it, but Kink gets a free kick. In the centre of the ground, a drive Collingwood further upfield, beyond centre-half forward, and in front to take the Marcus Pickett. Well, as Harry said, a couple of goals may encourage him. It's amazing the voice that these Collingwood supporters can find. They've been down all day. They know they're going to get whacked, walloped and whatever you like, and yet they can still find some voice to cheer on their champions. And it's Pickin now lining them up directly in front of goal, but he's missed. It's Collingwood's 20th behind at the best. It is. Yeah, that's all it is. And Collingwood go on to 6 goals, 20-56. They trail Richmond 18 goals, 20-128 on the 3OW Carlton United scoreboard. Malthouse was going up to the line, but he saw Robinson indicating that the goal umpire was still waving the flag, so he had to stop and go back and do it again, which he's doing now. Comes to the line and kicks to the outer side of the ground, looking over there for Lee. Lee knocked it back, as he has often today. Got it to Raines, who hand passed to Bourke. Bourke kicks to the centre wing position, and Collingwood, through Craig Davis taking the mark, will go into attack, and he kicks high, but it's going to go over the line out of bounds, and it'll be thrown in the forward pocket for Collingwood at the scoreboard end of the ground. Collingwood are 6-20, trailing Richmond 18-20, and we've played 11 and a half minutes into the last quarter of the 1980 Grand Final. The ball spins back into play. Dunn knocked it out, gathered in by Rayshaw. A quick shot for goal is going to go across the face of the big sticks and through for yet another point, and Collingwood go on to 6-21. It's remarkable to think that they've had 27 scoring shots when you reflect on what's happened today, but they're 6-21, total 57, and that trails Richmond's 18-21-28 on the 3OW Carlton United scoreboard.
And Mervyn Keane says, can I have a kick? And give me a chance to kick in, which he does. He kicks out to that half-back flank, over there looking for Mark Lee, punches the ball away from big Craig Stewart, and the ball goes out of bounds from the punch by the Richmond Ruckman. So now the throw-in, and Lee has been on the ball all day. Up he goes, he taps it down nicely to Francis Burke, left foot kick by that player to Jimmy Jess. Jess takes the mark and immediately starts looking for Bartlett. Bartlett's signalling, but now the ball goes high down towards Cloak and Co. And Roach is there as well. Up goes Perkins, off the hands of the pack, straight to Bartlett. Bartlett on its way, through for a goal. He's kicked five. He's got five. And the interest now is, can the little champion, can he get, say, another three to get the all-time record in a grand final? I don't know whether he can or not, but by word, the way he read that pack, the ball came off the pack and like greased lightning he had it, and he just made it so simple as he raced into that open goal and put it through for Richmond's 19th goal on the 3OW Carlton United scoreboard. They've got 19-21-34 to Collingwood 6-21-57.
Well, at the centre bounce, and Lee comes in and wins it again. What monotonous regularity, we've said that. Knocks it up towards centre half forward as the pips for 5 o'clock go through 3AW, the top station for football, and it's taken out of the centre by Ray Shaw, who kicks to the centre half forward spot. Pickin leads out in front to take it under control and hand pass to Shaw, coming downfield, and he's kicked over to the outer member's side of the ground where Craig Davis stretches, goes and takes it out of bounds. It was just in the last dive that he backed over the line, and he knew it, and it's over the line out of bounds to be thrown in directly in front of our commentary position in the member stand, overlooking Collingwood's half forward line. Lee comes in to thump it out of the pack again, over towards the line it goes, but about 10 or 12 metres further upfield towards the Richmond goal on the member side of the ground. It's 14 and a half minutes into the last quarter, with the playing time merely a formality. Richmond 19-20 can now afford to give their captain a run. All he's done is Monteith has talked to the players at intervals and tossed the coin. It's knocked out and picked up by Tony Shaw. Onto the left foot he goes to kick it up towards the centre half forward spot. In front of the pack is Stephen Mount, and that youngster takes the mark to relieve the pressure for Richmond. They are 19-21-34, Collingwood 6-21-57 on the 3OW Carlton United scoreboard.
Here comes Stephen Mount, played a good game at centre half back all day. Up it goes towards the big fella in Lee, taps it out the back over towards Raines. Raines gets the ball moving, keeps it going toward Wood. Wood can't quite trap the ball. It's trapped by Ray Byrne of Collingwood. And he kicks long, but Francis Burke comes in and takes the easy mark on the chest. And a lot of clapping for Francis Burke, considered one of the great players in league football. And his kick has found Wood. Now Wood will try and find Bartlett. Mount's coming off and Monteith's coming on. And the ball over now to Rowlings. Rowlings kicks long towards the goal. Puts it out of bounds on the full. Out of bounds on the full. And the free kick right down in that last line of defence will be taken by Andy Ireland at Collingwood.
is right beside the behind post after the 15 minutes of play into the last quarter at the punt road end, kicking down, trying to find Craig Stewart, punched away by Wiley. Wiley down, finds the ball going to Magro, and Magro hand passed the ball back very nicely to Young, and Young for Collingwood has kicked the ball out of bounds. So the ball is out of bounds on the half forward flank for Richmond. On the members of the northern stand side of the ground, tapped down by Big Cloak. Cloak in turn gets it toward Wood. Wood to Smith. Smith's twisting and turning. He had to evade a lot of tackles there. It's quite a good effort for Andy Ireland to get it down to Weirmouth. Weirmouth takes the mark. Hand pass the ball out toward Tony Shaw. He's going to be pounced upon there, but he still manages to move it. He moves it over to Kink. Kink was beautifully tackled. Brown called the umpire. As it comes back now to Mervyn Keane. Mervyn Keane to Mark Lee. Lee out wide, trying to find a teammate over there. He's got him. That's Raines. And they're looking for Bartlett. Bartlett's on his own. If he wants to give it to him, he doesn't. He doesn't want to give it to Bartlett. It's a lovely long kick, and it's going to go close. And oh, it's a great mark for Richmond's Cloak. And he's 1 metre out from goal. If he likes to tap it through, no, he decides he'll go back and have a shot. So, big Cloak. David Cloak going back, heavy shot at goal at the punt road end, and he is 1 metre, if that, may only be half a metre out from goal. He goes back a long way to take his shot at goal, heads over the ball, it'll be his fifth goal if he puts it through, and he shouldn't miss it. He certainly hasn't. He's kicked it right up the top of the stand, the southern stand, and that's his sixth goal, is it? Yes, six to David Cloak, and at the 17-minute mark, Richmond now have got a very, very big score on the board. They've got 20 goals now. 20 goals, 20, 140, 20, 20, 140 on 3LW Carlton United scoreboard. And Collingwood are 6, 21, 57. And maybe Cloak will be the one to break the record.
Kevin Bartlett signalling to somebody in the outer, signalling as if drinking a glass of something, saying you can start your celebrations. Well, it's come out of the centre, and Rowlings knocked it further back, only to see it picked up by Morris. Morris in the centre of the ground has kicked it high, probably 30 metres upfield towards centre-half forward. It's knocked away. Tony Shaw going in courageously there, knocks the ball out in the direction of Mearbouth, but Rowlings climbed over the top of him. Eventually it went to Pickin picks up towards the forward pocket. Monteith, it's against him, reaching over the shoulder there of Olsen, and Olsen takes the free kick. He was about to make off with the ball. Umpire Robertson telling Monteith to come back a little bit as Olsen fires for goal, and this looks as if it's good. It might be a goal. It is a goal to Collingwood from the boot of Olsen, kicked at the 18-minute mark in the last quarter, and Collingwood have moved a little closer, a little. Richmond remain on 20 goals, 20, 140, and Collingwood are 7-21-63. The next target for Richmond would be to kick a record for a grand final, but I think that's a bit too far away from them. It was 28-9, I think, from memory, Ray, wasn't it? 28-9, which is 6-8, 160, 177. So it's a long way away. It's back into the centre of the ground with umpire Della, who's done pretty well today when you reflect on what the umpires have done. They've come through it all right. And he comes down to put the ball on the ground, slaps it down strongly. Lee and Moore. It went down to to Raines. Raines got it out to Wiley with a hand pass, and back to him it comes, eventually to Smith. And Smith kicks from the centre of the ground up towards Cloak, leading upfield. Off his hands it goes. A chance here for a hand pass to Bartlett from Roach. And Bartlett's kicked his sixth goal. Well, that's six to Bartlett and six to Cloak. So they're each within a goal of the record of seven kicked by several players.
Goal-kicking record set by Jack Mueller in 1934.
Well, that's what Ray tells us. Jack Mueller kicked 20 goals in the series in 1934, and Bartlett's equal that. So that's just how great that little fellow is.
Well, he's got a big chance now, and the next time he gets that goal, there'll be a lot of transistors in ears right around the ground. So then the message is he's equaled Jack Mueller's record of goals in finals matches, and of course he's also got a great opportunity now of equaling, if he gets another goal, equaling the most number of goals in the grand final. It was Peter Moore, kicked it out to punched it out over in turn toward Wood. Wood gave it to Wiley. Wiley's trying to find Welsh. Welsh will try and warn it was Rowlings, and here comes Morris tapping it away from Rowlings, grabbed it, put it down toward the full forward zone, the centre half forward zone. An opportunity for Raines. Raines hand passes it out. It's coming out to Monteith. Monteith's got it. He'll go for a hand pass toward Dunn. Dunn in turn will hand pass again. He must. Over to Kane. Kane to Malthouse. He let it run right through his hand. Malthouse
There's an opportunity for King. King tries to get it across to his Tony Shaw. Does it well. Shaw taps it back. Over towards Stewart. Stewart up to Picken. Picken's mark. And Picken, Pick will, I was going to say, is seen picking himself up off the ground. But he fell awkwardly then, Billy Picken, after taking that mark. And he has a chance to kick his third goal for the day. Now, Billy Picken, moving back, he was the only goal kicker for Collingwood during the third quarter. We're waiting for Billy Picken to line them up. The time gone is 20 minutes. And so about another 10 minutes for Kevin Bartlett or David Cloak to equal the record or even pass it as the ball on its way. Jimmy Jess was talking to Magro there a few minutes ago. As we see Picken come in, line them up, and the goal umpire doesn't move. It's a goal, and Collingwood's got its eight. Eight on the board. That's 8 goals, 21, a total of 69. Richmond 21-20, 146, and 22 minutes gone. Care to predict, Rex, whether either Cloak or Bartlett will break the record?
Well, I think both players deserve to break the record because not only today have they been damaging and very constructive players for Richmond, they've been the result of Richmond's rise up the ladder this year.
Okay, the ball again lost. I think we've had a few today. That's five balls we've lost today. And back out it goes again, a new one to Bill Deller to bounce again. Well, somebody's having a birthday up there in the crowd, but they're packed in so tightly I don't think any of the police will be able to stop that. As we see the ball come back, yes, and umpire Deller bouncing with a new one.
Well, it's had a bounce, and Lee and Moore tapped it away from Lee's palm, follows on and slaps it further upfield. A chance for Dacos at centre-half 40, avails himself of the opportunity and shoots the ball in towards full forward, but Dunn's in front of Stewart, and Stewart yelled out, kick it up. Well, I thought his job would have been, it was to be in front. Anyhow, it's done with the mark, and he brings the ball around the member side of the ground up to the half-back flank. Coming from behind us, Wood. It was written all over it then that Wood was going to get it, and he's taken the mark. He looks across at Francis Bourke for the hand pass, and Bourke says no. Kick it long upfield. He's getting a signal from Monteith, but he ignores that, and he's kicked close to the boundary line around the centre wing position. Cloak was there, and he had a touch. It went to Ireland, who hand passed to Morris, who in turn will hand pass further upfield to Byrne. From the centre wing, he drives the ball up towards the half-forward line, travelling the man's flank, and it's a mark to Picken. It's a mark to Billy Picken. Well, Bartlett, time is running out for Bartlett and Cloak. Those that share, as far as I can recall, the seven goals in the grand final are Jesselenko, Lane of Essendon, Fordham of Essendon, Tommy Reynolds, Norm Smith, Dick Harris, that I can think of, and they each kick seven goals in a grand final, and Norm Smith. Picken now lining them up from the half-forward flank, and the kick is long enough, but it's not accurate, and it drops through for 1 point. And Richmond remain on 21-20, a mammoth total of 146. Collingwood have marched on to 8 goals, 22, and that's a total of 48, 68, 70 points.
Talking about Norm Smith, the Norm Smith Memorial Medal will be presented here today for the best player on the ground. It will be presented by Ron Barassi. Up goes Raines for that kick in and takes a big mark, kicked in by Francis Bourke. And out on that half-back flank, over it goes in the direction of Woolnough, and Woolnough's up in front of his opponent, Blakeman, there to take the mark, and a 15-metre penalty. And on he goes. Woolnough plays on, certainly Collingwood's best player, as it comes down toward Billy Picken, knocked away from that player, comes to ground, chance for Olsen. Olsen with a right foot snap, looks for Davis. Davis can't take the mark, through for a point, and Collingwood go to 8-23-71, and Richmond at 21-21-46. Almost 24 minutes gone now in the game as we wait for the ball to be kicked in, and it's going to be kicked in by Francis Bourke. Players are getting pretty tired, and the only interest now is whether we can find a couple of Richmond players, who may be able to equal that record. They are David Cloak and Bartlett. This one goes right up toward Wiley. Wiley takes the mark, and Weirmouth doesn't want to let him go. Wiley's going to kick it across because there's two players there on their own, and Raines gets it. Raines will kick this ball long. He's not worried about any record for Bartlett. He's forgotten all about that Bartlett has a chance as we see the ball come back now toward Malthouse. Malthouse gets in the back. Player calls the umpire. They're still after it. And eventually Richmond will get the ball. Might have been Welsh there. And Welsh had it. So too did Magro. And Magro throws the ball up to umpire Robinson, who will bounce. Half-forward line for Richmond. Up goes Lee, still taps it away with the one hand. Peter Moore, however, comes away with the ball.
kicks it long, out wide, trying to find Lowe. I can't recall calling him very much today. The ball tapped down and tapped over to Morris. Morris at Collingwood with a hand pass. Finds Ray Shaw. There's one bounce. Creates the loose man. Ball goes to Picken. Picken forced to go back for a set kick as Smith comes up and stands the mark.
So it's Picken to kick the ball with that wobbly punt. But it'll be a Richmond. No, it wasn't a Richmond mark. Almost marked by Francis Burke. Craig Davis has got it. He should goal from here on its way. And he's kicked the ninth goal for Collingwood. Two for nine, 9.23, a total of 77. Young Frayne coming on now the field. And going off will be Little Waitman. And so we find Collingwood 9.23, a total of 77. Richmond 21.20, 1.46. Now it's into a time on period. And unless Raines, when he does get the ball, if he can only look for Bartlett, we could get, or the crowd that's remained, and there's a pretty big crowd that's remained, would get a pretty big thrill. So let's hope that some of the Richmond players get the message out to their players, because it wouldn't be all that difficult to get another goal by Bartlett.
Umpire Robinson centre bounce, and Lee knocked it down towards Monteith, who couldn't control it. Moore came in to get it for Collingwood to hand pass to Ray Shaw at centre half forward. He plunks it under the left foot and kicks to centre half forward or beyond there to see Smith at Richmond take the mark. Smith between centre half back and full back for Richmond, kicking to the outer side of the ground and coming in front of the pack there is Jess. It's gone over the back to Lee, who takes the mark and hand passes to Prem, who has his first kick in the grand final. Kicks to Bartlett, and Bartlett nearly took the mark, playing on in front of Magro. He's having a bundle of wits there, and he breaks away from Magro and heads for goal, and he's put it on its way for what? It's a goal! It's a goal! And he joins him. He's equaled the record. Seven goals in a grand final, and the crowd know it. Make no mistake about that, because they've rose as a man to applaud the little fellow, and his teammates have come and patted him on the back. It's a magnificent sight to see such a wonderful footballer equal it, and listen to the crowd, Harry.
And let's hope that he can still get another one. And we wonder whether time will give him a chance. It's 27 minutes gone, and umpire Robinson coming in. Now Bartlett, one more to break the record. He's equaled it. Down goes the ball by umpire Robinson. Mark Lee will take it out the back, over toward Frame. Here's an opportunity that's almost like grass at the moment, as the ball comes into a pack of players, and umpire Della will bounce the ball. Kevin Bartlett up there at almost centre-half forward. As the ball is put down again, up will go Peter Moore. He'll tap it away all right. That comes out toward Lowe. Lowe breaks two tackles, kicks long for Collingwood. Right down towards Craig Stewart. Stewart can't take the mark. Malthouse is running up. The ball's close to the boundary line. It's out. And the ball will be thrown in. It is now up to 27 and a half minutes gone in the 1980 Grand Final. And there's just about 2 minutes to go. And the ball at the Collingwood end. And we want to see Kevin Bartlett break that record. Up goes the ball into the air, punched out, and it's been punched out of bounds yet again. The score is, on the 3LW Carlton United scoreboard, Richmond are 22-20, 152, Collingwood are 9-23, 77.
Well, it's in the left forward pocket for Collingwood, out of sight at the scoreboard end, high for the throw-in as Pickney grabbed it out of the pack, and umpire Della's watching closely as a hand pass comes out, kicked off the ground by Francis Burke. Tony Shaw dropped the mark, gathered in by Raines. He'll hand pass to Monteith in turn. Hand passes to Rowlings. Here's a chance if they can create Bartlett. Rowlings' kick has gone into the forward line. Cloak running across, but McCormick comes across the path of the ball, takes it under control, kicks into the centre of the ground, knocked further into the Collingwood forward line on the outer side of the ground, the half-forward flank, but Kane, a great player all day, takes it with consummate ease, has a bounce, kicks up to the forward line, and Monteith is lurking there. He's taken the mark on the half-forward flank, across to Wiley. Wiley can give it to Bartlett if he wants to, and he didn't, he ignored him, and Bartlett sunk to the ground in despair in the first instance. He got up to applaud the goal kicked by Wiley, and one wonders what they are saying to each other, because that was the golden opportunity to see 8 goals kicked in a grand final. But Wiley kicked one, and Richmond have gone on to 23-20, 158, Collingwood 9-23-77, and that 23-20 of Richmond is a goal that's 8 points better than that losing score they had in that famous grand final with goal.
Well, the ball's back with umpire Bill Della now, and he's about to bounce the ball, and there's only about one or so minutes left to go in this game, and the ball comes back to Peter Moore. Peter Moore gets it round the neck and will take the free kick. Going back now to Peter Moore. And I don't think Kevin Bartlett's going to get the record. What a pity, because Wiley had the golden opportunity. But
That was Wiley's third goal as the ball is kicked long right down toward Dunn. Dunn's taken the mark for Richmond, and they're all very tired. If they could just keep it moving, the ball might be able to be worked up there again, and Bartlett might still get an opportunity. The ball out toward Welsh. Welsh takes the great mark, goes down, and picks himself up very quickly. A lot of Richmond players in the packs. There's a chance for Freem. He'll take this mark on his own, and he'll run clear. He's going to run. One bounce, no one near him. Two bounces, and now he kicks toward the centre of the ground. Up will go Cloak. He can't take the mark. What's he going to do? Is he going to try and hook it back? No, he's in over the top of it. It might have to be a ball up. Umpire Della calls for the bounce. Now it's 31 minutes gone. And a tap out, and if Kevin Bartlett happens to get it, that's his last chance. The ball up into the air. Goes over to Bartlett. Bartlett toward the goal. Puts it through. Oh, it's a point. Bad luck. A point. Oh, he was directly in front too. Had the chance. And this is the only last piece of excitement left for the 113,000 odd people that came here today. 113,461 people today for this match. Last year was 112,845. Ball about to be kicked in by Peter McCormick for Collingwood. Down toward Mark Lee. Over the back. Came out toward, this time, Francis Bourke. He gets it toward Freem. Umpire Della calls for another bounce. 32 minutes gone now. Richmond 23-21, 159. Collingwood 9-23-77 on 3LW Carlton United scoreboard.
Della hits the chalk line at centre-half forward for Richmond as he bounces the ball. It's gone into the centre of the ground. Olsen might get a free kick, and he does. Might be the last kick of the grand final. Who knows? Olsen has kicked over to the members' side of the ground and coming out as Pickin to take the mark at 32 and a half minutes into the last quarter. Pickin on the half-forward line, kicks it across to Shaw. Shaw further up on the forward line, takes the mark, kicking to the scoreboard end of the ground. 23-21 to 9-23. Ray Shaw lining them up at 32 minutes into the last quarter, and it's gone on and on and on. It'll be a merciful relief for Collingwood when that siren goes, because they've never looked a chance from quarter time. The kick by Shaw has gone up to the full forward spot, taken out of the pack by Craig Davis, and a strong kick has gone right across the face of goals, out of bounds on the full, and the free kick will go to Mickey Malthouse of Richmond in the left back pocket, at defending at the railway or scoreboard end.
Okay, well, Mickey Malthouse will take this kick, and we're just ready for time to run out now. And there's been no time on blown there, so that robs Kevin Bartlett of a few more seconds. Up toward Peter Moore, can't take the mark, the ball comes to ground. In will go Ray Shaw, he's bumped aside. Players are over the top of it, and umpire Robinson calls for another bounce. 33 minutes gone now in this final quarter, as we see Richmond 23-21 taking out the 1980 grand final. 159 points to Collingwood, 9-23-77. Still Collingwood cannot get a win in the grand final. Ball kicked back there by Tony Shaw. A chance for Smith, and Smith will take the free kick. Billy Pickin throws the ball up, or punches it up, and Greg Smith takes hold of it. Siren only seconds away. Greg Smith kicking down long, trying to find Mark Lee. He punches it on, punched it out of bounds, and the ball to be thrown in right in front of the members' stand. Cameras, television cameras all around Tony Jewell and the rest of the team down there, as they're all very, very happy. And, of course, they've got the 1980 Premiership Cup, and they'll be taking it home. The tap out, and it comes over to Dacos. That was a bad piece of play than you would have seen by Ray Shaw. The ridiculous type of tackle on young Freem, and Dacos has put it through for another behind. Well, maybe the game's never going to finish, as we see Robinson come over and talk to Ray Shaw. Robinson hasn't missed a trick today. One of the good, best exhibitions I've seen him give, as the ball comes down to word Kane. Shake hands, and that's the end of the 1980 Premiership. And up goes Bartlett on the shoulders of his great mate in Francis Bourke. What a great thrill it is for them all. Richmond have won the 1980 Grand Final 23-21, 159 to Collingwood 9-24-78. And little Kevin Bartlett, the hero yet again of the final series, with seven goals. He's finished with seven. That means he's equaled the record, and he had two great opportunities in which he could have even beaten the record. Wiley could have given it to him, it was an open goal, and Kevin battled hard to get the ball himself, and into the open goal he went. He had to kick a little high because there was a player, an opposition player, bearing down on him, and he kicked it wide, through for a one behind only. He had plenty of opportunities today, Kevin, and his personal stats probably saw him kick about 7 goals for. I'll just get a check on that from Ray Young. 7-5 he actually kicked. 7-5 Kevin Bartlett to miss the record. But the premiership has gone to the Tigers, and they've had it wrapped up virtually from the first quarter, when at quarter time they were 6 goals 5, 41 to 2, 6, 18, and virtually it was not a contest at all from that point on.
Kevin Bartlett on camera now. What a magnificent performance he's put up during the final series. Kicking, 21 goals, and today equaling the most number of goals kicked in a grand final, kicking 7 goals. And Tony Jewell going out there to give his centre player, Raines, a bit of a hug. And what a great player he was too. But when you look through the, there's Jimmy Jess, started off magnificently. What a happy man he is. Giving the runner a bit of a cuddle, and they'll have a big celebration in Richmond tonight. There's David Cloak, he finished up with 6 goals. When you look through the Richmond lineup, it was very hard to find. Well, you couldn't find a weak player. There's Mark Lee, who dominated the ruck, and he had a very difficult job because he was playing against Peter Moore, who's had a great season for Collingwood, but he dominated the rucks.
Down there is Tommy Lahiff, and Tommy said with us, yes, Tom, take it over. Tommy Lahiff talking there to Kevin Bartlett. And as I've told you, Tommy Lahiff out with our special microphone, right out in the centre of the ground. Plenty of activity going on out there. And already one spectator being sent off the field. And the players are very happy. The dais already set up, waiting for the players to come over for the presentation of the Premiership Cup. Tommy Lahiff, any time you want to interview any player out there, just go ahead. The Collingwood players coming back on the field now, and I think the league officials are going down to Collingwood and players and asking them could they come on down to the more official part of the dais, and I think that's what's going to be asked of them, would they mind coming down. The umpires, board men, the control board, are going off the field. Great exhibition today by Richmond. Real powerhouse stuff, this. And signs of what we can expect in the 80s, I would think. Collingwood coming down. Collingwood team coming on down toward the dais. We've felt in the past that this has been one of the anti-climaxes for the losers. Of course, they've had to sit down and wait. Dejected. Yes, Tom? Well, I've almost got my head knocked off then. As Tommy is about to try and interview somebody down there.
Yeah, thanks, Tommy. It's absolutely magnificent. I'll tell you what, you wouldn't want another better thrill in your life. Unbelievable.
Well, the magnificent part of Brad, it was there when we brought him in. Well, Tommy, you know, we haven't had much publicity, you know, throughout the year, and I think that everyone might have underestimated us just that little bit. I'll tell you what, we played magnificently.
Well, everybody did. This is your first premiership.
First premiership, and I'll tell you what, there's more to come, I think. I hope.
Thanks very much, Geoff.
Thanks,
see you later.
Geoff Raines there, Tommy talking to. And, I'm not too sure whether Tommy can hear the presentation. Dr. Alan Aylett just announcing the premiership win to Richmond, and very shortly he'll be presenting the cup, or the governor will be. Tom Barassi making the Norm Smith presentation medal. Kevin Bartlett's been selected. And what a great honour. Okay, Tom, I'll just leave it there for a moment as we see the Collingwood team coming up now to be presented to the Governor, the Captain Ray Shaw. Medals for the runners-up this year, which is a great idea. Peter Moore going past there now. Tried his heart out. The toll of the extra games, I think, made quite a difference to him. There's a player up there with the Richmond Guernsey on. That might be in low. I think it is. He's got. He went from 16 to 16. He gave away a Collingwood 16, then got a Richmond 16 and Brian Woods Guernsey. And Andy Ireland going through there. Peter McCormick taking Michael Roach's Guernsey. Rene Kink, David Young. Played in several positions today, David Young. And so they go through. Ray Byrne. Ricky Barham limping through. Bad luck for Ricky. He's been plagued by those leg injuries, the hamstring. Did it in the first 2 minutes of play today. There's little Magro going through. And he got a Guernsey out of it all. And he got Peter Welsh's Guernsey. It might have been, Russell Olsen. Now the Premiership Cup is about to be handed over. And the Governor will present it. There's no doubt about that. It was a brilliant display of Grand Final football. Charlie Callender out there. Been around Richmond for over 50 years. Francis Burke. Going up. Get his medallion. Stephen Mount played a great game today. Centre half back. Wasn't beaten all day there. Through go the players. Another big lad. I'll go their big side. Robert Wiley, who could have. Well, possibly remembered Bill for not giving that hand pass to Kevin Bartlett. Barry Rollins very happy. Emmett Dunn played well all day. In fact, who didn't? Yes, Mickey Malthouse, former St Kilda player and been a great player. Geoff Raines, of course, one of the key players in the win today in the centre. Mervyn Keane with those long goals today, kicked two beauties, 60-odd. Michael Roach, who kicked over 100 goals for Richmond today, this year, to... well, Mark Lee, possibly best on ground. Well, they'll get a big cheer again. Seven goals equals the grand final record. Peter Welsh. Yes, he did get his Guernsey to Magra. And... Jimmy Jess started at centre-half forward. This young boy got the ball down of the dying stages to Kevin. And young Terry Smith, who played strong. And now the captain and the coach will go up shortly, Bruce Monteith and Tony Jewell. Tony Jewell, the hero of the 1980 football season. He's won it. He's won the accolades, and here's Bruce Monteith to get the cup. Well, there are several captains out there, and he's got the trophy. Interesting to know just how many captains were there.
Yes, they gave him the honour of taking the cup.
Right, now I think Tommy Lahiff may be going to speak to Tommy Hafey. There's Tommy down there. Righto, Tom.
Tom? Yeah, well, they were just much too good, Tommy, weren't they?
They were on the day, Tom. They did everything you'd have wanted your boys to do.
Yes, they just were too disciplined, much too good. They wanted the ball more, and I was very disappointed with that we couldn't put up a better fight.
Well, I think they put up a magnificent fight to get where they did, Tom.
Oh, well, I don't look at it that way. You know, we were there on the day, and we just... I guess we tried our hardest and didn't somehow up everything went unstuck. Players have been playing well coming up to this match. Just didn't seem to get in the game at all.
Oh, well, that's just how it does, Tom. But I think overall, I know that how you feel. It's terrible to get beat, but you've had a magnificent season. And once again, you've upheld the reputation of Tom Hafey as the coach.
Thanks very much, Tommy.
Thanks very much, Tom.
Tom Hafey, leaving Tommy Lahiff, and Tommy Hafey still in his t-shirt, looking very fit, but he'd be very disappointed as he moves off the ground, because he realises there's no prize for second, and this was a very poor second too today, but they were simply outrun, outclassed, and although we said it last year, Carlton with their medium-sized players may have been going to bring something new into football, and you made that point during the day, Bill. I have a feeling there's nothing that can compare with pace, height, strength and power.
Well, somebody a long while ago said that a good big man will always beat a little man. And the same thinking still applies today, and it always will apply with big men. Of the power and skill that Richmond had today, they'll always beat a medium-sized team. Given a day like today, let it be borne in mind, we had great weather for the grand final.